There's a reason that we live so far from Hollywood. In the country, looking hard to find a home. We're nothing perfect or considered, but we're so damn good. It's the story of your life.
Morning, glory, America. Bonjour, hi, Canada. I'm Hugh Hewitt on the West Coast for three more weeks. But following the war, I hope you were watching Special Report last night. I got to chime in on the State of the Union tonight. I'll be back on with Brett today in the pre-State of the Union show. And I'll, of course, dissect the speech tomorrow live, everything that the president says and doesn't say. I hope he declares sanctions on Russian oil and gas. This is the most important thing right now. We continue to finance the war by continuing to buy Russian oil and gas. We ought to put a complete embargo on it, as we have on Iranian oil. We ought to sanction people who take delivery of it. It's 1 out of 10 barrels of oil sold in the world comes from Russia. It's how they are paying for the cluster bombs. It's how they are paying for the rape of Kyiv and Kharkiv. And I got a chance to bring this up last night. Britt Hume had been on earlier with Brett Baer, and they've been talking about the oil. Britt's right over the target on this as well. So he came to me and asked me about it. Here's the first cut from last night's show, cut number 13.
Hugh, I talked with Britt about the amazing outpouring from European nations, some that have not been active on this front before, and a change in tide there. But what the Biden administration is doing and not doing is a factor ahead of the State of the Union address tomorrow.
Well, I heard Britt say what I also believe, Brett, and I heard that exchange. We have to sanction Russian oil. Russian oil is paying for cluster bombs that are killing children in Kyiv and Kharkiv and other cities throughout Ukraine. There is a direct line from Russian oil, the money that comes in, the invasion that's underway, the atrocities for which hopefully war crime trials will be held. 57% of people asked by Quinnipiac in a new poll release today, has President Biden been too tough, not tough enough, or just right? 57% said not tough enough. I think they are talking about the oil sanctions. We need to stop that oil. We need to do it yesterday. Hopefully he'll announce it in the State of the Union.
That's what I'm hoping for. Brett came back, though, and said, come on, what's the over-under on anything like that, Hugh? Cut number 14.
But, Hugh, the possibility that President Biden is going to say something like that about energy here in the U.S. at the State of the Union is probably what percentage?
5%. But if he does not, I hope tomorrow night, Brett, that Nancy Pelosi in her last State of the Union behind the president rips up the speech like she did, because unless the president does that, children are going to continue to die from cluster bombs in the big cities of Ukraine.
And Brett said the over-under that zero. Tearing it up. Just remember tonight when you watch, it's Nancy Pelosi's last State of the Union. There are small blessings everywhere. And I doubt she'll tear up this, even though if the president, maybe he will. I'm hoping that he will. He's behind. He's been behind. He's been consistently behind Europe. I was amazed this morning to read that the rest of the media has figured this out. Everybody else has figured out we are way behind Europe. And the good news from the Washington Post. Quote, over just a handful of days, Europe was shocked out of a post-Cold War era in which it left many of the democratic world's most burning security problems to the United States, close quote. Bad news in the same Post article, the continent leapfrogged the United States, which wasn't prepared. What a surprise, Joe Biden wasn't prepared. So the latest developments, there is this massive column, I'm sure you've seen, 40 miles of tanks and armored personnel carriers. It has been stopped for a period of time outside of Kyiv. Nighttime is when it moves. Nighttime is when the Javelin missiles come out. Russia is counting on that to destroy Kyiv. They're just going to do Chechnya tactics, Grozny. 20 years ago, they leveled the city. They are dropping cluster bombs on Kharkiv, which is the second largest city 30 miles from the Russian border. They're trying to get to Kyiv with the kind of artillery that will do that. The European Union says 400,000 refugees from Ukraine have already crossed into neighboring. The ambush report comes from the Telegraph this morning. That long, long column has been hit by Ukrainian artillery and drone strikes. And military experts say It's doubled in size overnight on Monday and was a sitting duck for Ukrainian artillery and drone strikes. About 20 miles from where it was last spotted, the Russian advance appears to have hit a wall. In Bucha, I don't know if I'm saying that correctly, it could be Bucha, 15 miles northwest of Kyiv, images posted online show the bloody aftermath of one of the most brutal ambushes and firefights of the five-day-old war. In Kyiv itself, Russian special forces troops were halted at the by guards at one of the city's most famous religious landmarks. A photograph showed what appeared to be a Russian corpse lying close to St. Michael's Golden Dome Monastery, which the local Orthodox Archbishop issued a statement claiming that saboteurs had been neutralized. As talks were taking place in Belarus, Russian troops faced being massacred on the roads into the capital. If Russians were being killed by church guards, the resistance could clearly be no pushover. Well, we don't know. Eventually, force has its way. That's why we have to, we shocked the Russian economy yesterday. Investors struggled to trade Russian assets as the sanctions hit the market plummeting. The losses of Russians yesterday, ordinary Russians, were extraordinary. As global investors with at least $150 billion in Russian securities are trying to dump them, and as Russians are trying to get rubles, and the ruble declined in value by 30% yesterday after a precipitous drop on Friday, the Russian people are getting wiped out. Meanwhile, Russia finally got kicked out of the World Cup. FIFA originally said, oh, they can play, they just can't call themselves Russia, proving that they're not just corrupt but stupid. It took a day of people like me saying stuff like that, and it's not really deeply insightful. It's simply obvious that it's stupid. The whole world is disgusted with Russia, wants nothing to do with Russia. State liquor stores are pulling Russian vodka from the market. That means eventually the sales back up. That's good. That's everything. Everyone in Russia should pay for their dictator. At least 70 Ukrainians are missing after Russia targets a military base in Oktyra, the regional governor says. Finland is beginning to talk about NATO membership. Good. Britain will not enforce a no-fly zone. That's good. We do not need NATO on Russian dogfights. Russians might shift to night operations. Yeah, it's not going to help if you're firing because the guys with the javelins can find you. Thank God Trump sent javelins in 2017 and 18, 19, and 20. Not at the speed they should have gone. There were screw-ups in the Army. There were concerns about where they were going to be stored. It's all Mark Esper-related stuff. But Trump said send them. They got there. Now they're being taken from wherever they were being stored to the front and being used. Airstrike has hit a big government office in Kharkiv this morning. Big, big explosions. And the blockade on Russia's central bank, according to the Wall Street Journal, neutralizes defense against sanctions. And the U.S., according to the Wall Street Journal, is positioned to withstand economic shock from the Ukraine crisis. That's because, of course, Russia's like 3% of GDP. Their economy is 1/20th the size of, 1/12th the size of our economy. They can't hurt the West, and that doesn't count Europe. All they can do is drive up our gas prices. So my question to you is, 1-800-520-1234, open up the phones, Ben. Will you be willing to take some pain at the pump by sanctioning Russian gas? I am. It's already expensive, right, to drive anywhere. But the only way to stop this, and when they began using cluster bombs on kids yesterday, that they just, Putin has said, take the city. He's gone with the Napoleon maxim, if you're going to take Vienna, take Vienna. If you're going to take Kyiv, take Kyiv. That's great when citizens are not in the way, when you've been able to evacuate civilians and especially children and old ladies. But they haven't done that in Kyiv and Kharkiv. This is the fifth day, and they've already gone to cluster bombs. Now, Russia used those in Syria. They used them in Grozny. They are army-on-army acceptable weapons, right? Army-on-army, military-on-military acceptable weapons. They're not acceptable in a crowded city where the civilians are millions, many. That's just a terror campaign. And that's Putin. Now, last night on Special Report, there's also a lot of talk about whether Putin has lost it. I don't know if he's lost it. Doesn't matter if he's lost it. He's got commanders on the ground. They're committing war crimes. And I just want you to know, whatever they say, it doesn't matter. They're committing war crimes. By the way, on the White House lawn last night, Joe Biden got a shouted question. Cut number 9.
Mr. President, is Ukraine winning the war?
The president, you fear
use a nuclear weapon.
Mr. President, are you worried about nuclear war?
That's him ignoring nuclear war questions. You know, the president walks and talks like a really old guy. I hope he gets a nap today so he doesn't encourage the Russians more, but that infirmity is itself provocative. Don't go anywhere, America. 1-800-520-1234. Connection to the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you by Food for the Poor.
This is Hugh Hewitt for townhall.com. Buckle up for 2022. The year in politics is going to be rough. The midterm election year seems predestined to banish the Democratic majorities in both houses of Congress. The country senses infirmity in President Biden, and many worry that our adversaries in China, Russia, and Iran sense that opening too. The shadow campaign for the GOP nomination in 2024 opens now, with a clear frontrunner being former President Donald Trump. The ranks of the top tier among possible GOP presidential nominees in alphabetical order starts with two senators, Arkansas's Tom Cotton and Ted Cruz of Texas. Then we have the populist Florida Governor Ron DeSantis, the former Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, and South Carolina Senator Tim Scott. If the world grows even darker in the days to come, Cotton and Pompeo, two former soldiers, start with some advantages. It's possible one or more will run whether or not the former president does. My bet, with 3 years to go, is that Trump runs and runs hard. Buckle up. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
publicpolicy.pepperdine.edu. Trending now on the Larry Elder Show.
What the Supreme Court has said is you have to have a compelling state interest, and the compelling state interest that the Supreme Court found was the benefits that flow from having a diverse student body, whatever those benefits may be. But you have to have a diverse student body to get these certain benefits, okay? So that justifies this kind of racial alchemy in terms of admissions. Here's the problem. Increasingly at schools, you have, regardless of how supposedly integrated they are, you're getting more and more racial separatism, separate classes, separate dormitories, separate graduations. There's more and more of that going on. And one of the basic reasons for that is because of mismatch, because of the serious mismatch in academic qualifications between Asians, Latinos, blacks, and whites.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
You want to know what's even crazier and funnier in a sick way? There's a security guard right there. The shoplifter, the looter, walks right by the security guard who isn't doing anything. He's got a jacket on with the big security on the back of his coat. And he stands there and watches the guy. The guy literally brushes right by the security guard. The security guard, what are they paying the security guard for? Just to stand there? Why don't we just put mannequins up in stores in New York? I may never go back. I swear, I may never go back. New York is turning into a hellhole. And Democrats are watching it. They're letting it happen. I can't wait to get Joe Borelli's take on all of this insanity.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Hey, Welcome back, America. 1-800-520-1234. Alan in Tampa, Florida. Are you willing to sanction oil and gas from Russia, even if it means more at the pump?
Yes, temporarily. I mean, but I'd like to see the American energy complex get ramped up by this administration. I think it'd only be about 6 months before we'd be flooding the market with oil.
Well, that too. I think that is the obvious answer to production, is production. If prices go up, that's the, you know, the classic answer. The answer to high prices is high prices. People start opening up fields that have been abandoned. They start doing things that they haven't been doing, and they make the price go down. But that would require President Biden to actually alienate his climate nuts. And I'm willing to have him do that. Is he willing to? They got nowhere to go. They're not going to not vote for the Democrats in November. But I do think the images from Ukraine and the reports on the cluster bombs, don't you think that's going to matter? He could do it in the State of the Union tonight.
It'd be very easy to do. I mean, simple enough. All I have to say, okay, America, for the next 3 to 6 months, the prices of fuel are going to be going up, but we're doing it for the Ukraine cause, and we're going to put Putin, we're going to bury Putin under debt, and then all we have to do is ramp up our production and be independent of OPEC and Russia and everyone else that we're now becoming dependent on again under the Biden administration.
Yeah, the world oil, that's right. And Alan, thank you for the call. Drive safely down there in Tampa. The world's oil market is one market. If you add oil anywhere, you make the price of it go down everywhere. If you sanction it anywhere, you make the price go up everywhere. So we have to sanction Russian oil and gas to stop the cash flow into Putin, to cut him off, hang him out, and force him to stop. The biggest economic weapon we have left is the complete isolation. SWIFT was the second biggest weapon. They've kind of done SWIFT, but they did SWIFT to avoid hurting the oil and gas market. Well, time to hurt it. Market report brought to you by Birch Gold. And gold is up to $1918 this morning, a $10 rise from yesterday morning. And $1918 an ounce. Some of you have been regretting that you didn't put it into gold when it was at 16, then at 17, then at 18. Now it's at 1918. Not a question about when you roll over a portion of your assets into an IRA or 401k from Birch Gold. It's a question of when you take them out. Hopefully never. You get your 5 to 10% of your retirement stored by Birch Gold. They'll set up the physical depository. Your name goes on it. It's acceptable. It's kosher with the IRS. Been doing it for years. They got thousands of 5-star reviews. You send them the money, they buy the amount of gold that it purchases. At 1918, you get less gold than you did yesterday, but you still get a lot of gold. And then they put it into the vault, your name is on it, they send you the reports all the time. It's a very well-run organization. They'll send you a free information kit if you head over to send my name, Hugh, to 989898. Now let me talk to you a little bit about Food for the Poor. We got started yesterday. Thanks to all of you who made the first donations. I did not see the Fetching Mrs. Hewitt yet, so we haven't made ours yet. We'll end up doing it today or maybe on the first day of Lent tomorrow. Children in Caribbean and Latin American nations are very unaware of the war in Ukraine. They haven't got TV. They haven't got rice and beans. If they did have TV, they'd be focused on riots and assassinations in Haiti and in people heading north in Honduras and Guatemala and villages emptying out. It's a disaster. Food service, basic rice and bean service is broken down all over the world, especially in the poorest countries. Food for the Poor steps in. They keep doing it. Even during the assassination of Haiti's president, remember that when the Mercs went in and killed them and were finding the Mercs, and there was giant civil unrest that followed that? Even during that period of time, Food for the Poor kept delivering their rice and their beans. And they continue to do so now. Please go over. It's Lent. Please go. It's a Fat Tuesday, right? On Fat Tuesday, try and think of the skinny kids in Haiti and Honduras who are getting fed rice and beans while you're having your Fat Tuesday fun. That's great. Skip a meal today. You're going to be fasting tomorrow if you're an observant Catholic or a Christian that practices the old ways during Lent. And go over to the Give Life banner at the top of HughHewitt.com. Or call 855-359-HOPE. That's 855-359-4673. $88. $88 provides a hungry child with food for a year and water for life. That's an $88 gift. You can make that at givelifebanner at hughhewitt.com, and then come right back. Lots more coming up. Your phone calls at 1-800-520-1234. Should we cut off Russian oil and gas? Call me.
Streaming on Salem Now.
You called your son, and you personally promised him you would be here.
Lucas, I don't know how to help you.
Your daddy loves you, you gotta know it, pal. Do you feel
the love? Prayer is a powerful thing, Ethan. It really does work. If you believe.
What reason does he have to care about some guy who's supposed to be his dad, but he's never around?
I can't do it again. I'm not ready for this, man.
I'm done with you.
We all deserve a second chance. Right, Ethan?
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
This is Carol Platt-Lebow for townhall.com. Sometimes there are policies so destructive that at first you don't believe they're true. Joe Biden is currently defending one, his plan to award $450,000 to migrants separated from their families after entering the U.S. illegally. Children of deceased U.S. soldiers are separated from their parents permanently. They don't receive this kind of money. And migrants who enter the U.S. legally certainly don't get this kind of payout. The really big jackpot, it seems, is being reserved for the lawbreakers. There are some obvious truths here. First, behavior that's subsidized gets repeated. Joe Biden is effectively inviting many more illegal immigrants to breach America's open borders. Second, he's betting over time the payoffs will benefit his party in political terms. Meanwhile, the vast majority of Americans watch in shock and dismay as our president, the country's chief law enforcement officer, brazenly rewards lawbreaking, a clear violation of his oath to defend our nation's laws. It's a sorry sight indeed.
Trending now on the Charlie Kirk Show.
It seems like the Democrats tried their best to try to eliminate the filibuster, and it failed. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, thankfully, it did fail. Republicans stood united against that, as we have been from the very beginning, and Kyrsten Sinema and Joe Manchin also stood with us in preserving the rules and the customs of the Senate. These rules and customs go back more than 200 years, Charlie. They are directly downstream from where our founders created a Senate in the first place to provide the sober second thought against radical sweeping change to our country. It's pretty amazing that 48 out of 50 Democrats were willing to blow up the filibuster. They were willing to break the rules to change the rules. And Charlie, that would have just been the first step towards redistributing political power in this country. The Democrats' next stop probably would have been to make Washington, D.C. a state, our federal city that is by far the most liberal jurisdiction in America. So the Democrats could get two more Democratic senators in perpetuity. The next stop would have been to pack our federal courts to include the Supreme Court, to stop the courts from overturning any of these unconstitutional actions. This entire effort, Charlie, was not about just altering this or that public policy. It was about forever changing the structure of political power in our country. You sometimes heard the argument that, well, the Democrats shouldn't do this because the shoe was on the other foot. Their entire goal was to make sure, Charlie, that the shoe would never be on the other foot. So it was a critical day in the history of our country and the history of the Senate as an institution. And I'm glad we stopped these radicals. That's why we have to turn them out of power in November.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
Streaming on Salem Now.
This is a story of how a million children were placed with local foster families through an unlikely alliance between the Chinese government and a British footballer. Parents from all walks of life share their stories of overcoming the one-child policy by taking in orphans. With unprecedented access across the country, This is a unique insight into the lives of the 90s orphans now driving the 21st century's fastest growing economy.
This story needs to be told across the world. At a time where there's so much negativity and cynicism, here's proof that a single leap of faith can change the world.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
America, it's Hugh Hewitt, rabbit. First broadcast day of the month. I know some of you get up at 6:30 in the east and not at 6, and you're late to the show. You never hear the rundown. I get that. 6:30 is a pretty common wake-up time. Not for me. You know, gotta get up at 5 o'clock, 4:30 in the morning if you're going to be ready for the show. And especially, I said to the fetching Mrs. Hewitt last night, I was turning in early. I said, you know, you can't do show prep when there's a war on. A war that is the only story that most people are interested in. And the reason you can't do show prep is because they fight at night, and then daytime comes when we go to bed, and then nighttime comes when we wake up. And it's not quite that stark, but it's pretty much that way. And they fight at night, and we got to wait for the next day to see where we're going. For example, most of the newspapers last night had stories on, and in fact, we talked about this on Special Report with Brett, had stories on this enormous column of Russian tanks and armored personnel carriers, and no stories on the ambush until I got up this morning. And they got hit last night bad by Ukrainian artillery and drones. Some pretty awful sitting duck stuff. So I will keep you posted every morning. It's a little bit different style. How long does this go on? The price that Putin is paying is high in terms of carnage in the Russian economy, but he hadn't felt it yet. The central bank in which his billions are kept have been sanctioned. He still hadn't felt it. I'm sure he's got villas full of cash around the world. We have to go get that. Mostly, though, we have to stop the resupply of their cash. And that means sanctioning Russian oil and gas, which the president has not done. The EU has not done. The EU has done a lot more than I expected. And the president has followed. He's leading from behind again. It's the Biden playbook. Don't do anything to lead, but do everything that they do. So he waited for the Germans, who miraculously have become real members of NATO. Real members. And I got to get Rick Grinnell on here and see if he's passed out. He spent 2.5 years in Germany demanding 2% and couldn't get it for the NATO budget. Got it up to 1.5%, got commitments. I mean, a lot more than Obama got, Trump got. But then all of a sudden, the new Prime Minister Scholz becomes François Mitterrand, for those of you old enough to remember the great French president who acted alongside of Thatcher and Reagan and Pope John Paul II. They all got together. They all brought the hammer down. And they had Helmut Kohl in Germany. So we got the band back together again. So now sanction Russian oil and gas. That will be the last shoe to drop. Yes, send as many arms as necessary. I'm glad Poland is sending their MiG-29s because they got pilots that can fly MiG-29s. They haven't got pilots that can fly F-35s or F-18s. We can't give them to them anyway. But they certainly can fly MiG-29s. And so Poland and some other EU countries are sending those over to Ukraine. And those columns become death traps as they get closer to Kyiv. Let me also, since the first day of the broadcast month, many of you have joined the audience. Not many, but you know, if we got 6 million people listening, a few hundred thousand of you are new or you're new to this time slot. I add affiliates every month, new platforms every month, new outreach every month. So I always do a quick bio at the start of every show every month. So here it is, March 1st. I'm from Warren, Ohio. All right, so if you've never heard of Hugh Hewitt before, I'm from Warren, Ohio. That's the best place in the world to be from, and I still like to go back to it. My brother still lives there. I have great friends there. Great middle-class community of America. That's basically the passed over country, an oil and a steel town and car town that doesn't do much in steel and cars anymore because those industries moved on. So they're coping as best they can. Former Ohio State football coach Jim Tressel leading the Youngstown effort. Warren's got good leadership. The land, as they call it, Akron, Canton, Warren, Youngstown, it's rebuilding slowly as Cleveland has. We got water in Ohio, so people who are building data farms are starting to figure it out. Oh, water and power, that would be Ohio. I think we'll go there. And Mike DeWayne doing a good job bringing them there. After Warren, I did 12 years of parochial education, great Catholic education, great sisters, great priests. Off to Harvard in 1974, 4 years there. Got in my car, drove across. I didn't get into Harvard or Michigan Law. They turned me down. Those are the only two law schools I wanted to go to. So I asked around, found a guy in D.C. named Ray Price. He said, I don't have a job for you, but David Eisenhower needs somebody on his book project in San Clemente. So I drove out to San Clemente, went to work for David. A couple of months later, the phone rings. It's Richard Nixon. Want to come to work for me? I had passed whatever test was going on there. So I went to work for RN for 2 years. We wrote the book, The Real War. And I was an editorial assistant on that book. It's so applicable to everything right now. The president had finished his memoirs. He was in exile still in San Clemente. He moved back to New York in 1980. I went with him. Great book. Then we wrote Leaders, which is Zelensky will make the next edition of Leaders. Whenever anybody writes a book about modern 21st century leadership, Zelensky's going to be in there. Doesn't matter if you're a comedian, if you've got courage. Doesn't matter if you've won the Ukraine dance contest, if you've got courage. If you've got courage, that's charismatic. That carries. That motivates people. So out to California, then to New York, and then I got into Michigan Law School. Then I went to law school, graduated in 83, went on to the D.C. Circuit for Judges Roger Rob and McKinnon. Judge Rob had a stroke, so for a while I worked for Judge Scalia, then on the D.C. Circuit, Judge Bork, then on the D.C. Circuit, Judge Ginsburg on the D.C. Circuit. They all rally around the clerks whose judge is sick, and they give you cases. So I got to work for Spots Robinson, got to work for Skelly Wright. Great judges. Bazelon was ill, so I didn't get to work for him. But good conservative judges like Robin, McKinnon, Bork, and Scalia. Great liberal judges like Ginsburg, Skelly Wright, and Spots Robinson. I had a great clerkship. Then I went to the Department of Justice. Then I went to the White House Counsel's Office for, it's a grand total of 2.5 years between those two jobs. Chased Russian, East German, and Cuban spies. Not literally. I just processed the search warrants. There was no National Security Division at Justice in those days. There was an FBI office and a special assistant to the Attorney General, and I spilled that special assistant role for Smith and Meese. Then I went to the White House under Fred Fielding and Dick Houser. Dick tried to teach me how to golf. Fred let me do some legal stuff. Dick, you know, he's a -2 golfer down in Florida, and he did not work his magic on me. He can play, can't teach. Fred, though, gave me great stuff to do, and Dick kept saying, let's go play. And I got to defend the seal of the presidency over here. Into the agencies, OPM, general counsel, confirmed by the Senate. So I'm the honorable to you, if you just call me honorable when you call. Then to California for 30 years of legal career, serving on various boards and commissioning, our Quality Management District, the California Arts Council, the Orange County Children and Family Commission, but building a practice and starting in radio at KFI in 1990, doing the weekends in KFI. Then I started doing nightly television for 12 years in LA for KCET, the News and Public Affairs program, Life and Times, won a few Emmys, moved on. Salem found me through the efforts of a bunch of people, but Ed Atzinger offered me the job finally. And I started this show in July of 2000. So we're coming up on our 22nd anniversary. All along, I've been married to Fetching Mrs. Hewitt, who did most of the child raising of our three wonderful kids. All of them have left California. All of them. Two boys and a girl. They're all gone. I've got three grandkids and a couple more on the way. I'm in great shape. I've had a great life. I'm happy. But when you live in America, you get certain responsibilities. So I've always written books and been on the media, worked for NBC for 5 years. Now the only show I do is Brett's. And the reason is I like serious news. I want you to know what's going on. I want you to know that the Russian use of cluster bombs is a war crime. I want you to know that tonight we ought to be looking for the president to sanction Russian oil and gas. It's the last big weapon we have is to cut them off entirely. Every bank, every transaction. I love it when I see that the Berlin Symphony fired Valerie Gregory. He's a friend of Putin. The conductor of the Munich Philharmonic, no more. He's gone. Zelensky has accused Russia of war crimes as Kyiv braces for a new assault. So I like to bring you news like this, that the tech giants, Google and Facebook, are doing the right thing thus far. They're taking down Russian bots. They're taking down Russian media. 411 people have been arrested in Russia as Putin cracks down on the anti-war movement there. It is a great thing. And Switzerland, of all people, got involved and sanctioned Russia. Switzerland never does anything like that. We are doing the right thing. We are doing the right thing. Remember, Ukraine is a very Christian country, both Orthodox and Catholic. So you can pray for them, and you're actually doing what they're doing for themselves. Lots of great pictures of ladies in babushkas praying in Catholic churches and Orthodox churches across Kyiv and Kharkiv. The Russian advance on the sea is the most concerning to the professionals I know. The Russians are terrible. They're just very badly trained. A Marine Corps general retired sent me an episode. They're bad troops that win only because they use inhuman tactics in Syria, like the Syrian army, cluster bombs, mow down civilians. Would they use chemical weapons? I don't think so. They are using cluster bombs, which the United States uses, by the way, against other militaries. We do not use them in civilian areas. We came into a lot of grief early in the Iraq War when one was used, rightfully came into a lot of grief when a cluster bomb was used in a civilian area. So the munitions themselves are not illegal. It's how they use them. The Russians fired them into an apartment building yesterday. They killed a bunch of kids. That's what they're going to do. Russian conscripts are deserting. The javelins that Trump sent and that Europe is now resupplying and Biden is sending slowly, 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 are making all the difference in the world. The cost is so high that Putin is not going to change his mind. I do not engage in psychological speculation because I don't know Putin. You don't know Putin. And people think he's unstable. They don't have a medical evaluation for that. Condi Rice goes on and says, this doesn't look like the Putin I dealt with. That's a legit comment because she can relate back to actual experience. People have never met Putin. Don't tell me what you think about his mental state. I don't know your mental state. Callers call me up. I don't know their mental state. I can tell pretty much when I talk to someone if they're around the bend. Really, it takes less than 5 minutes. Give it a try. 1-800-520-1234. Should we sanction Russian oil and gas? It's the last sanction we've got. Cut off the oil and gas banks, sanction the purchasers, up our production. The president can announce that. I mean, this is going to be a bad speech tonight. The president's not good at this. It'll be a celebratory moment because it's the last time Nancy Pelosi's going to have the gavel behind him. Time for relieffactor.com. Got to stay up late tonight. Got to watch the State of the Union. It'll be a long day. There you go, relieffactor.com. I use it every day at this hour. I'll remind you about it in hours 2 and 3. Very easy to open. If you're watching on the Salem News Channel, you just saw me open that in 5 seconds. I'm Karen Kirkham and Resveratrol Omega. Got a frog in my throat. I'm Karen and Kirkham, Resveratrol and Omega. Those four are the natural ingredients that make it very easy for your body to fight back against minor aches and pains. If you haven't taken it yet, you deserve to give yourself a shot. You deserve to give yourself the opportunity to feel good every single day. All you need to do is open it, take it, $19.95 for the starter pack, 3-week trial. Find out if it works for you. In the meantime, call 1-800-520-1234. We're going to talk with David Drucker after the break about what to expect tonight. The president's numbers are so bad. 57% of America don't think he's been tough enough on Russia. 37% of America think he's doing a good job. These are horrific numbers for the first year of a presidency. The 31st member of Congress announced their retirement, Democrat Ted Deutsch, last night. Yeah, he took the job as chief executive of the American Jewish Committee. You know why he got out? Because he's going to get tossed out. People are getting out left and right. Democrats are running for the exit. So they'll show up tonight for their last State of the Union. They don't have to wear masks, by the way. What a surprise. Mask mandate is over. In time for the State of the Union. I'm really shocked. Really, really shocked. School parents aren't going to forget. They're not going to vote for a Democrat. And they're not going to vote for any Democrat unless Biden gets very, very tough on Trump, on Putin tonight. Stay tuned.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by Stamps.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
¿Cuánto queda?
No queda nada. Que lo siento mucho.
I must see the time you can come to Christ. When the Spirit of God calls you. Well, don't you hesitate!
Have you ever thought of going to seminary?
Madre, padre, ¿quién está listo para ser transformado por el poder de su palabra?
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com. For Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
This really is a Leninist that people in the West didn't want them. But number two, there was a lot bigger sense of social cohesion during the Cold War. The notion, if you're a corporate executive during the Cold War, that you would be playing footsies with the Kremlin was outrageous. And yet, in the case of China, the human rights situation, the challenge to American national security is every bit as great, I would argue perhaps even greater than it was in the Cold War era. But Wall Street, Silicon Valley, they are all happy to not only do deals with them, but do deals with them that benefit the Chinese military and intelligence state. And they don't seem to particularly care that they do.
Well, there was stigma in helping the Soviets. There's no stigma in helping the Chinese communists.
That's right. And I think that, you know, part of that is there's been this naivete for decades that if we just gave China money, if we gave them access to our technology, they were going to buy our blue jeans, they were going to watch some of our movies, they would become just like us. What's really happened when you look at issues like censorship by big tech in the United States, when you look at some of the other things that are going on, it's not that China's become more like us. We've actually become more like China. And that experiment has to fade away. And the problem is not only were our elites wrong in their prescription of that policy, but that policy made them rich. And they do not want to now give up those relationships with Beijing because it means the money is going to stop flowing.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Welcome back, America That Music Means. David M. Drucker is in the house, the author of In Trump's Shadow, and friend of Dwayne. Maybe he'll have Dwayne pick up. I just sent Dwayne a clip of Boris Johnson speaking in Poland, incredibly powerful. Drucker, though, won't have seen that yet. Good morning, Drucker. How are you?
I'm great, Hugh. Thank you.
Are you going to the State of the Union tonight?
I'm not going to the State of the Union. I'm actually traveling in Ohio as we speak, and I'll be in Cincinnati probably discussing before the State of the Union this evening. I'll be discussing my book, but probably discussing foreign policy and what is happening in Ukraine. As you know, there are a lot of Americans of Ukrainian descent or recent Ukrainian immigrants to the United States that live in the state of Ohio. So,
well, they're mostly in the real state of Ohio. I'm sure people have told you Cincinnati's in Ohio, but it's not. It's Kentucky. And that's just a line drawing error. But the Ukrainians are up in Cleveland, where all the great Americans live, are up in the northeastern Ohio area. Are you doing a book signing and a book talk tonight, David?
Yes, I am.
Where?
you know, I've got to look at my agenda. This thing has been set up by my Sherpas, and there are two different places I might be. I've got a luncheon in Columbus where I'm going to be talking about the book and signing books. Yesterday I started in Cleveland. I ended the day in Youngstown, which is where I am now.
Did you go to Warren?
Yeah, I'm at this place called the Grand Resort, which is actually a rather nice place. I spoke to a chamber of commerce here yesterday evening, and I'll be hitting the road after we get off the line.
Well, I hope people listening on 98.9 in Columbus look up David Drucker. He probably doesn't have a website. You have to go find, just Google Drucker in Columbus, and go Google Drucker in Cincinnati if you're listening to me on WMOH or on my Dayton affiliate. He's definitely worth listening to. What do you expect from the State of the Union tonight, David?
Well, I don't know what I expect, Hugh. I've been thinking about this for days, at least since the invasion of Ukraine. And, you know, I think it's a very pivotal moment. What happened is this State of the Union is now a very pivotal, important speech, not just for the president politically, but internationally and historically. And there are a number of policies the president could propose that would further put the screws to Putin and pressure him with everything short of, you know, a U.S. military intervention, which is not going to happen, obviously. And I don't know if we're going to see all of those screws proposed. I do know that part of what matters is his tone and his rhetoric and adding something to the mix, even if he won't go all the way from a policy perspective. And what I mean by that is I don't have a lot of confidence that he's going to propose energy policies that will reflect the previous administration just because of how important climate issues are to his political base or to the Democratic Party's political base. But there are other things he can do, including increasing military spending, immediately asking for a supplemental from Congress, so that more lethal aid can be rushed to Ukraine, so that the U.S. military can beef itself up and people can see that we mean business. And so I'll be curious to see if he does any or all of those things, and also how the speech is delivered. And we know because of this, there are going to be very important viewers around the world watching this. The numbers aren't that important to me, the ratings, because we know that among those who do watch will be key viewers that need to get a message.
Well, I also think Putin will be watching closely. I'm hoping he announces sanctions on the purchase of Russian oil and gas, David. People debate that, you know, at a 37% approval, he can't actually let gas prices rise in the United States by limiting the oil market. And he's not going to increase supply dramatically because of the fanatics in his party. But I think Americans will absorb the hit if they understand they've got to stop the cluster bombs falling on children in Kharkiv. And I, this is just the beginning of the atrocity. We're going to film this. This isn't like Chechnya. There are many, many people with... Did you see the pictures out of Kharkiv this morning, what they did to the town center there?
Not yet. I was scrolling through trying to get a picture of the news and where things are, so I was reading about it.
Yeah,
but I have not yet seen the pictures.
It's pretty devastating. And I don't think you can go wrong by being too tough on Russia. But Quinnipiac yesterday said 57% of Americans don't think Biden's been tough enough. Now, whether you think that's unfair, that's the reality. So if he comes off infirm tonight, that's going to get worse, isn't it?
Yes, it is going to get worse, which is why I said part of what is important for him to project in this speech, both domestically but also for the international audience, is not to project infirmness, is not to project an idea of weakness or anything other than resolve and the fact that action will continue to try and pressure Putin to withdraw or make this as painful as possible. And so the imagery and the rhetoric has a lot of importance, even though the policies do matter. And I do agree with you, and I think we've seen this around the world, and one of the most fascinating things about what has happened is to see the grassroots revolt in Europe. This isn't just European leaders revolting against Putin. They have the support of their voters. We have not often seen that.
I'm going to be explaining that when we come back, America. Don't go anywhere. David M. Drucker, go get his book, In Trump's Shadow, and go find him in Columbus or Cincinnati today. And David, if you send me a link to your appearance schedule, I'll find a way to post it on Twitter. But If you just Google David M. Drucker, Columbus, David M. Drucker, Cincinnati, you'll find him. You folks in Kentucky can go over to the Cincinnati book signing. Stay tuned. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
Streaming on Salem Now.
The Democratic Party somehow has convinced black people that they're the good guys, never mind the skanky history of the Democratic Party. That was a party of slavery.
He said, listen, I gotta give these niggas enough. Not too much, but enough that I'll have them voting Democrat for the next 200 years.
The race grievance industry would have you believe that blacks get up and think about nothing else except race.
If I tell you this is racist, yeah. I would get you emotional.
There is a whole big cottage industry for racism. If racism went away, a lot of people would be unemployed.
The mob during the Minneapolis riots following the death of George Floyd, a bunch of white thugs, frankly, burning down the city's traditional black and Asian business district.
They're racist, 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 racist. Everything's racist.
It's the devil!
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Trending now on the Eric Metaxas Show.
When you had the president in Atlanta saying to the crowd there that, you know, he didn't march in the shoes of the students that are marching today, but that he marched in the civil rights movement, and he remembers the first time he got arrested, when he never marched in any civil rights movement and has never been arrested.
I mean, can we even believe this? That he routinely says things that everyone knows are made up. Nobody calls him on it. Look, this is why we do. You do your program. I do my program. We need to do our best to get the truth out, and we have to be clear. The president, he's plumb loco. I don't know what is going on. I guess I would say this. I'll bet that within his administration, there is very nasty fighting because they see what we see. I'm sure Kamala Harris despises the Biden gang, and the Biden gang despises her. They have to keep that quiet. But it's really something that I think they're going to consume their own.
The Democratic Party knows that they're in trouble. When you say that their staff sees what's going on and we all see it, we got to remember one other thing. Vladimir Putin, Premier Xi, the leader of North Korea, the leader of Iran, these people all see it too. And there is a message being sent globally that America is a laughingstock right now, that the bowl of mashed potatoes that serves as the president in the White House right now is nothing more than a suit.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe today at rumble.com. Trending now on the Larry Elder Show.
Could you let that happen for 10 weeks of your children being kept in a box in the library, excluded, put on display, and so on and so forth for that long? I kind of feel like, and I can tell you are a very caring mom, which is why you're bringing this public, but I kind of feel like that would happen for 2 hours, and I would be down there at that school and pulling my kid out, much less 2 to 10 weeks. Did they really endure that for that long?
They really did that for that long, and I really appreciate that question, and I've gotten that question a lot. And how we looked at it as a family is we could pull them and just go about our lives, and they'll just do this to someone else, or we could stay and fight and hold our ground. And my kids didn't want to leave that school. They've been in that school, my son, since first grade to eighth grade. They had their friends there. We still had hope that the trusted adults would do the right thing. And we eventually have pulled them to homeschool. But during those weeks, we were fighting. We have hundreds of emails to the administration, the Dallas ISD school board. We went down, and I brought 30 or 40 grandmas and grandpas and other parents from other schools down to fight and speak on our behalf. Parents even scheduled protests, 3 protests outside the school. So we were fighting, but I think at this point in our country, the war has come into the family, and our kids can no longer be shielded from it. They needed to be guided through it, which we did as a family, to build a backbone and learn how to stand up and fight, because this is their next generation. So instead of shielding them from it, we helped them move through it with grace, integrity, and dignity, and they came out stronger.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
You called your son, and you personally promised him you would be here.
Prayer is a powerful thing, Ethan. It really does work, if you believe.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
This is Hugh Hewitt for townhall.com. Buckle up for 2022. The year in politics is going to be rough. The midterm election year seems predestined to banish the Democratic majorities in both houses of Congress. The country senses infirmity in President Biden, and many worry that our adversaries in China, Russia, and Iran sense that opening too. The shadow campaign for the GOP nomination in 2024 opens now, with a clear frontrunner being former President Donald Trump. The ranks of the top tier among possible GOP presidential nominees in alphabetical order starts with 2 senators, Arkansas's Tom Cotton and Ted Cruz of Texas. Then we have the populist Florida Governor Ron DeSantis, the former Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, and South Carolina Senator Tim Scott. If the world grows even darker in the days to come, Cotton and Pompeo, 2 former soldiers, start with some advantages. It's possible one or more will run whether or not the former president does. My bet, with 3 years to go, is that Trump runs and runs hard. Buckle up. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
Publicpolicy.pepperdine.edu. Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
Look at you! Ow! Hey, look at that! I wasn't ready for that.
And there goes Peter Dinklage beating the crap out of Will Ferrell for calling him an angry elf. I mean, listen, he's certainly not an elf, but he's an angry guy. You know, I hate to put everything in a political perspective here, but isn't it true? And I assume Peter Dinklage is no conservative. He's woke. He wants to cancel Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. Why do they always want to cancel everything? You know, they want to cancel everything. What do conservatives believe in? We are for things. Biden's always saying, "What are Republicans for? Not for anything." Yes, we're for everything. We're for people. We're for people's right to make decisions about their health. We're for movies. We're for different views on the airwaves. We're not for people being canceled or movies being canceled or things being canceled. We're for things. And your side, Biden, is against everything. You're against Snow White and the Seven Dwarves. Oh, I mean, Disney obviously taking it seriously because they're redoing the whole movie, I guess. Do you portray them as children? Should child actors play the Seven Dwarves? You're going to get little Billy or Susie, who's about 9? The Seven Dwarves in Snow White aren't children. Grumpy isn't a kid. I mean, in fact, that would be a great, if they're casting people, maybe Peter Dinklage can play Grumpy. Because he fit right in.
Rumble.com.
Morning, glory, America. Bonjour, hi, Canada. I'm Hugh Hewitt. Amazing footage out of Ukraine as the Russians begin to just randomly target downtown Kharkiv with devastating missiles. I'm joined by Byron York of the Washington Examiner, Fox News Channel. Good morning, Byron.
Good morning, Hugh.
I am hoping that tonight in the State of the Union, the president announces sanctions on oil and gas coming from Russia, because that's the cash cow that Putin is using to pay for this. Do you expect that will happen?
No, I don't.
I think the president has been a bit of a follower in this. Listen, I think his caution has been basically a pretty good thing. I mean, we've had voices, you know, we've had voices saying he should impose a no-fly zone, or maybe that Western, you know, NATO forces should attack this convoy or something, doing things that I think that would be disastrous for the United States. So his caution is a good thing. I think that he has a chance tonight to inspire people in support of Ukraine and in support of sort of democratic world order, but it's unlikely that he will do it because he is Joe Biden. We have a situation where, you know, the last four polls for Biden in looking at Real Clear Politics of polls, job approval 38, 39, 40, 38. So he's clearly been sinking quite a bit.
Quinnipiac yesterday said that 57%, which is a big number, of Americans think he has not been strong enough vis-a-vis Russia.
Yeah,
that's a big number saying he's weak. Leading from behind is back.
Well, because a large number of them have serious doubts about whether he is physically and mentally up to the job. But what you're seeing here on the Democratic side and on their sort of cheerleaders in the press is this hope that there's a possibility for kind of a reset in the Biden presidency. If you look at the headline of Politico Playbook yesterday, it was a presidency transformed. If you look at a New York Times analysis, they said the dizzying events of the past week are redefining the arc of his presidency. So they're looking at this as a possibility to sort of redefine the Biden presidency from a presidency that was bogged down in the border, in inflation, in failed spending initiatives, and create a more heroic narrative of him supporting Ukraine.
Yeah, Byron, the actual record is appeasement abroad, inflation at home, teachers union first, students last, and parents last, open southern border, closed police precincts. That's it. That's the T-shirt.
And there's something interesting also going on, which is that, you know, this is the State of the Union is a traditional, what is called the laundry list speech, and some of them have just been appallingly bad of both parties, the laundry list speeches. And so there's some talk that Biden should kind of abandon the laundry list and give a stirring speech about Ukraine, which, again, I don't think he's really up to doing. But what's interesting is, you know, the crisis in Ukraine has just not stopped the rest of American politics. I mean, Biden, for example, has a constituency that's angry that he has not prioritized climate change enough. So they're really going to want to see that. And what you and I would say is the obvious thing that the United States should do, which is reopen its entire energy production capacity, is something he could never, ever do. Congress is still doing stuff. You know, the Senate yesterday voted on a radically pro-abortion bill. It lost. They only got 46 votes for it. But the Democrats in the House and Senate are doing stuff, and the president's speech will be about more than just Ukraine, even though it's all that, you know, you and I are talking about.
Yeah, and that's really a dumb strategy. And if you're listening, Ron, rewrite the speech. It should be short. It should be focused. The American people don't want to hear about child tax credits tonight. Here's Boris Johnson in Poland. This is an example of how a leader leads earlier this morning.
A woman from my team is now in Bila Cerkva, and she is there with two kids, and Russian military is over there, and she's so much afraid that she will be shot. Kharkiv, the city where I was studying, was bombarded today, fully, the downtown square. So you're talking about the stoicism of Ukrainian people, but Ukrainian women and Ukrainian children are in deep fear because of bombs and missiles which are going from the sky. And Ukrainian people are desperately asking for the West to protect our sky. We are asking for the no-fly zone. We are saying in response that it will trigger World War III. But what is the alternative, Mr. Prime Minister? To observe how our children are, instead of planes, are protecting NATO from the missiles and bombs? What's the alternative for the no-fly zone? We have planes here. We have air defense system in Poland, in Romania. NATO has this air defense. At least this air defense could shield the Western Ukraine so that these children with women could come to the border. It's impossible now to cross the border. There are 30 kilometers of lines. Imagine crossing the border with a baby or with two children. I'm so glad that Samantha Power is coming here to the border from the Polish side. Let her come to the border from Ukrainian side and see that. Britain guaranteed our security under Budapest Memorandum. So you're coming to Poland. You're not coming to Kiev, Prime Minister. You're not coming to Lviv. Because you are afraid. Because NATO is not willing to defend. Because NATO is afraid of the World War III. But it is already started. And these are Ukrainian children who are there taking the hit. You're talking about more sanctions, Prime Minister. But Roman Abramovich is not sanctioned. He's in London. His children are not in the bombardments. His children are there in London. Putin's children are in Netherlands, in Germany, in mansions. Where are all these mansions seized? I don't see that. I see that my family members, that my team members are saying that we are crying. We don't have where to run. Well, this is what is happening, Prime Minister.
Well, thank you.
Thank you is all you can say. The eloquence there, Byron, is from the reporter, right? Not from the Prime Minister.
Well, I just heard two words from the Prime Minister. You're right. It's not. Right. But it was an impassioned plea in favor of something that the United States and NATO are not going to do. We have had talk. Adam Kinzinger, the Republican member of Congress, called for a no-fly zone a few days ago. We've had other people call for a no-fly zone. She's calling for a no-fly zone. And the reason is, I mean, you see these aerial photographs of this enormous Russian convoy headed toward Kyiv. And I think any American or military person would think highway of death. I mean, this is something that United States or NATO forces could just take out if they wanted to start a big war in Europe. And they're not going to do it. So I understand the frustration in that voice, but Boris Johnson did not say, okay, we'll do
it. Well, we're not going to do a no-fly zone, but there is this video.
Well, that's what he was calling for.
I know, but there's this video that's out now about Kharkiv, where they've destroyed the center of Kharkiv in random bombing. And I think the president has to answer that. And so if he doesn't answer the emotion, I think that that question transmits Ukrainian emotion and Western resolve and European reaction. And the only thing we can do, we're not going to do a no-fly zone, no kinetic contact between American NATO troops and Russian troops. People have to understand that. We're not doing that. But we can sanction Russian oil and gas. We could do that, Byron. And you're saying you don't expect him to do even that?
Well, there are further, you're absolutely right, there are further economic sanctions that we could do. Although the economic sanctions that Biden has imposed, I'm sure he would say, have just been in place for literally hours, I mean a couple of days. And these are things that, remember at the press conference the other day, he said, well, let's have a conversation in a month and see where they are. These sanctions are not designed to immediately cripple, I mean by noon, cripple the Russian economy. They're designed to take effect over a longer period of time.
Well, so, but they don't have a month. Kharkiv is already basically, but they got kids getting killed. I think the president tonight, the stakes are high because he's got to show he's doing everything he can. Byron, last word to you.
I think the thing, the greatest worry, I mean, that I personally have, I mean, the goal is to get Russia out of an independent Ukraine. I think all of us have been struck by how bad the Russian military has been and effective the resistance has been. And I think what we're thinking about now is trying to get Putin to have some sort of exit ramp out of Ukraine before doing something like he did in Grozny in Chechnya.
He's begun that this morning. And so I'm just saying the president tonight is going to be speaking against the backdrop of impatience that is international. Byron York will be on, I'm sure, Fox News tonight talking about the speech. He'll be writing about it in the Washington Examiner. Follow him on Twitter at Byron York. Follow me to the next segment on the Hugh Hewitt Show. This is Hugh Hewitt for townhall.com. Buckle up for 2022. The year in politics is going to be rough. The midterm election year seems predestined to banish the Democratic majorities in both houses of Congress. The country senses infirmity in President Biden, and many worry that our adversaries in China, Russia, and Iran sense that opening too. The shadow campaign for the GOP nomination in 2024 opens now, with the clear frontrunner being former President Donald Trump. The ranks of the top tier among possible GOP presidential nominees in alphabetical order starts with two senators, Arkansas's Tom Cotton and Ted Cruz of Texas. Then we have the populist Florida Governor Ron DeSantis, the former Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, and South Carolina Senator Tim Scott. If the world grows even darker in the days to come, Cotton and Pompeo, two former soldiers, start with some advantages. It's possible one or more will run whether or not the former president does. My bet with 3 years to go is that Trump runs and runs hard. Buckle up. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
publicpolicy.pepperdine.edu. Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
Look at you! Ow! Hey! I wasn't ready for that.
And there goes Peter Dinklage beating the crap out of Will Ferrell for calling him an angry elf. I mean, listen, he's certainly not an elf, but he's an angry guy. You know, I hate to put everything in a political perspective here, but isn't it true? And I assume Peter Dinklage is no conservative. He's woke. He wants to cancel Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. Why do they always want to cancel everything? You know, they want to cancel everything. What do conservatives believe in? We are for things. Biden's always saying, "What are Republicans for? Not for anything." Yes, we're for everything. We're for people. We're for people's right to make decisions about their health. We're for movies. We're for different views on the airwaves.
Trending now on the Charlie Kirk Show.
So I think in their strategy meeting, they said, okay, people say that Joe Biden's mental decline is impacting his ability to govern. Let's shoot Joe up with whatever sort of kind of adrenaline that is necessary and deploy him out there. I think the point was to try to show that Joe Biden was going to go over the top long to try to win kudos and praise from the establishment media. This is his first press conference I think he's done in quite some time. Some people said it was his first ever press conference as president. Second? Okay. That was his second press conference. Trump used to do these almost daily. He did them for fun. And I will say, for reasons that we can speculate, the media was pretty critical. They were direct, precise. Now, nowhere even in the ecosystem, nowhere even in the atmosphere of questions towards Donald Trump. And I agree with my friend Tucker Carlson. The press conference was totally weird. It was a strange deal. Joe Biden leaning in, he does this thing where he kind of like hunches over the podium. You notice that, Connor? And he kind of puts both of his arms down and he looks directly at the reporter. And then he whispers, "You're exactly right." And he was still calling from a pre-selected list of reporters. And there were multiple blunders that came out of that. But if the point was to try to show the nation, look, hey, if you have any concerns about how sharp this guy is mentally, I mean, come on. He stood there and talked for 2 hours. I don't think that mission was accomplished.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Welcome back, America. It's Hugh Hewitt on Fat Tuesday. I hope celebrations in New Orleans and other places muted in response to what is becoming quickly a disaster of human rights epic proportions in Ukraine, where Putin has opened unrestricted warfare on civilians in Kharkiv. The pictures are devastating. The President of the United States has a State of the Union tonight. He should begin by announcing a wholesale blockade of Russian oil and gas. And I tell you, it's too late. In a month, children are dying, civilians are dying. They need to act right now. Ernie in Ohio, do you agree, Ernie?
He definitely needs to do something, but I don't see him doing it because wasn't that deal with Hunter get paid off through Ukraine?
No, I'm not. I don't think he's going. He's not captive. He's doing everything the Europeans are doing, unfortunately. So he's not doing less, but he could do more. I don't think it's a Hunter Biden thing. I think Joe Biden has been wrong about every foreign policy decision for 40 years. He's wrong again. Hey, Ernie, thank you. Chris in Maryland. Go ahead, Chris.
Good morning, Hugh. Yeah, of course he should. I mean, we're funding this through his impossibly bad policies. I mean, he's already made such a mess of it. But you know he's never going to do it. The best I'm hoping for tonight, Hugh, from tonight's episode of the Jalero show, is that he doesn't start a nuclear war.
Well, there is a chance that he would be provocative. I don't think, mostly they're going to try and get him off the stage without making a mistake. Hey, thank you, Chris. I want to remind people about my new sponsor. It's an old sponsor. Stamps.com is back, and I'm so happy. Because a lot of small businesses listen to me every single day, and their owners are on their way to work right now. And the people who run their offices are on the way to work right now. And the people who make the books balance, the CFOs are on their way to work right now. Save time and money with Stamps.com. Inflation is here. Everything costs more. Your postage doesn't have to. Your postage can go down. It's indispensable for over a million businesses that use Stamps.com. You save time, money, stress. You don't have to go to the post office ever. You get your postage from your computer at a discount of up to 40% off. What the USPS rates are, 76% off of UPS. Whether you're in office sending invoices, or you got a side hustle like Etsy going on, putting out shipping orders, whatever you're doing, use stamps.com. Go to stamps.com to make your life easier. Stamps.com and use the code Hugh, H-U-G-H. 4-week trial includes free postage and a digital scale, but you got to use my code Hugh, H-U-G-H. Pretty easy to remember that. Also easy to remember that Fat Tuesday means Lent is tomorrow. You know, celebrate today, but maybe you bookend your celebrations with a donation to Food for the Poor today over at HughHewitt.com. $88 feeds a child for a year and provides water for life in the devastated island nation of Haiti. And you can give more. Fetching Mrs. Hugh and I will be making our donation. We'll talk about it tonight, make it on Ash Wednesday, which is tomorrow. But you can bookend Fat Tuesday, make a donation today, and make another one tomorrow. And as you do that, offer up whatever sacrifice you're doing for the people who are getting blown up to bits. And I mean hundreds of them in Kharkiv this morning by Putin and Putin's forces. Boy, I hope he sanctions oil and gas. Food for the Poor needs your help. And every year this audience steps up. Sometimes you get a $3,000, a $5,000, a $10,000 donation. Maybe you're that rare person that can do that, but I'll take $10 and $50. Breadth and depth, breadth and depth. That's what this audience has to come through with, is breadth and depth for foodforthepoor.com. Please do that. Also, unamericanexpress.com, new sponsor. I'm going to talk with the president of it. The Color Us United campaign is exposing woke companies like American Express, who are now hiring on the basis of race. I believe it is close to illegal under the statute. If the government was doing it, it would be unconstitutional. Please head to unamericanexpress.com and listen a little bit later when I talk to Kenny, who is the president of Color Us United. ReliefFactor.com, final sponsor of the show. ReliefFactor.com, I want to talk to Admiral Stavridis the whole time next hour, so I'm not doing it next segment. ReliefFactor.com is what I'm reminding you about right now. I know you're a little bit taken aback. I normally do that in the third segment. I'm not doing it now for this reason. Admiral Stavridis has been everywhere. He's got to be very proud of his NATO troops that are doing the resupply. We'll talk about what he's seen. It's one of the general officers I like to speak with because he actually knows what he's talking about. Admiral James Stavridis coming up. Go get your relieffactor.com during the break, because you got lots to do and you don't want to get left behind by anything. Relieffactor.com. Admiral Stav is next on The Hugh Hewitt Show.
Portions of The Hugh Hewitt Show brought to you by Sierra Pacific Mortgage. For more info, call 888-888-1172.
Powerful organs of the state are not merely corrupt, but that they've been weaponized to go after perceived domestic enemies. And that's very scary.
Our constitutional democracy enshrines the peaceful transfer of power.
We are now all rooting for his success. The peaceful transition of power is one of the hallmarks of our democracy.
We don't live in the United States of America as any of us would like to understand it.
We have a peaceful transition of power process. That's not what happened.
They interviewed General Flynn, and they did it in what was a complete ambush.
I thought it's early enough. Let's just send a couple guys over.
And the audience was, ha, 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 ha. How funny to set up an innocent man.
This is what third world security states do. They spy on their political opponents like this.
This is part of a concerted Russian influence operation.
Russian interference.
They colluded. They were in on it.
He would constantly say, I have seen evidence of collusion.
Until this is released, I can't comment.
I can't go into the particulars.
Russians, I'm not going to be specific.
But he knew he could just say it on TV and then hide behind, well, it's all classified, I can't get into it.
Well, it's classified. You can't see it.
Collusion. You just got to be willing to see it.
New York's Daily News ran this front page, Trump is Hitler.
How could 62 million Americans vote for Hitler? Are 62 million Americans Nazis?
We really almost thought it was a joke. Like, really, you're not gonna accept that you lost this election?
Then they see the Russia collusion narrative sitting right there in front of them and say, why don't we just say that he cheated?
It divided the country in ways that people can't imagine. It's inspired massive violence. It's given people who are bad faith actors a license to do whatever they want because they literally feel like they're fighting Russian spies and Nazis.
Russiagate has been the most egregious abuse of everything that was supposed to have been good about our government.
The thing that they were investigating the Trump campaign for is what they themselves were doing.
Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
Operations, you find that they have this concept that loosely translated English means big help with a little bad mouth. And basically what that means is they're willing to allow people they do deals with in Congress, the Biden family, on Capitol Hill, Wall Street, they're willing to allow those individuals to provide some criticism because they recognize that it maintains credibility for those individuals.
Wow.
But what they don't want, Dennis, is for them to sort of go to the third rail, which is number one, cut off Chinese access to Western capital markets and restrict the flow of technology, not stolen technology, but technology given to China. They don't want those two elements stopped.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Trending now on the Eric Metaxas Show.
Was Sonia Sotomayor saying to them that there were 100,000 children in hospitals, many of them on ventilators? Eric, I went and looked up the data immediately. If you follow me on Instagram, you know that I've posted regularly the death rates of COVID-positive people and heart disease and cancer. There are only 119,000 people hospitalized for COVID in the nation as we sat there that day. So you're saying 100,000 of them were children when the data shows that only 5 children are hospitalized out of every 100,000 hospitalizations. There were maybe 6 kids in the hospital.
To understand that when leaders lie, when they do these kinds of things, it hurts people. It usually hurts poor people the most. And we have many in the evangelical church who have absolutely turned a blind eye. Again, this rises to levels unprecedented in American life. I mean, it's one thing to say we have differences. This is a level of political theater, of lying and grandstanding that is so pernicious to the fabric of the republic.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe today at Rumble.com.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. That music means I'm joined by Admiral James Stavridis, retired United States Navy, former Allied Supreme Commander of NATO, former head of the U.S. Southern Command, now the chairman of the Rockefeller Foundation, a partner at Carlyle. And Admiral, I've seen you in a lot of places. I just want to step back. How do you think the war is going? What has caught your eye?
The war is going less well for Russia than I think many people believed. Personally, I always had a certain level of confidence that the Ukrainians would fight hard, be able to at least slow them down. And I based that on personal experience. The Ukrainians fought under my command in Afghanistan. They deployed on NATO missions all over the NATO region. They've been part of NATO, although not a former ally. So I've visited many times. I know the spirit, shall we say, of the Ukrainians. You're seeing that on full display. So I think some have been surprised at the level of resistance. Now, quantity has a quality all its own, an old Russian saying, and gradually, I think, unfortunately, the Russians will grind them down. So that's been a pleasant surprise to many. And as well, Hugh, I've been flat out surprised that the Russians haven't pulled the cyber weapons out of the bag. I think they are holding those off almost as war reserve. They don't like showing them technically to the West because it gives us the opportunity to reverse engineer them and blunt them. And those are the two things that stand out for me right now. I'll give you a third, actually, since you and I often talk about leadership. President Zelensky has become just a profile in courage. And not just that, a lot of people can be courageous. He couples that with pretty extraordinary communication skills. The speech he gave at the EU, the speech he gave at the Munich Security Conference, his one-liners, you know, I don't want to ride, I want more ammunition. His physical symbolism and changing out of his suits and into hunting gear. You got to like that guy a lot. So it's been a tougher slog than I think Vladimir Putin counted on. I think it'll be tough ahead, and I think the Ukrainians are going to be able to hold on to the western part of their country is how I score the whole thing, and thus we may end up with yet another frozen conflict at the end of the day.
Admiral, I want to touch about the EU's offer of airplanes. I gather these are MiG-29s that are in the inventory of some NATO countries. Does Ukraine have the pilots necessary to fly these?
They do. And that's a very good thing. And if you look at those long Russian columns headed inbound and you look at Russians just flying transports for logistics, there's some big fat targets. And yes, 3 NATO nations have operated the MiG-29s, old Warsaw Pact, notably Poland, right across the border. And yes, the Ukrainians have flown them as well. The Ukrainians have pilots who have flown everything in the old Soviet, current Russian inventory. So those are very useful addition to their kit.
Are you surprised that the Russians haven't yet seized control of the skies?
I am surprised. And I think that there's a another issue here for Vladimir Putin. You know, the old saying in the military is that professionals study logistics while amateurs are worried about strategy. I don't think that's entirely true, but I suspect Vladimir Putin's generals were pretty focused on the strategy and not enough on the logistics. And two indications of that, one of which you mentioned, they haven't truly consolidated control of the sky. Both, there are still Ukrainian jets flying around. There's still Ukrainian anti-air systems in place. The U.S., believe me, would have taken all that out in the first 48 hours. The other problem is the pure logistics, moving fuel, food, blood, everything you need to the front lines. Pretty clearly, that's part of the slowdown here. And it's related to, final point, related to the fact that the Russians came in on at least four, maybe seven axes, however you score it. And, you know, when you attack everywhere, sometimes you attack nowhere because you've divided your forces. They underestimated the Ukrainians and they overestimated their ability to go in on multiple axes. They're paying the price.
Now, tonight is the State of the Union, Admiral, and I hope that I hear the president announce sanctions on Russian oil and gas, because the export of oil and gas, the last thing they've got, we very carefully crafted the sanctions to avoid hitting that, because Europe and the United States, to a certain extent, depends upon Russian oil. But with these pictures this morning from Kharkiv and atrocities and the use of cluster munitions against children and women and civilians, I don't know that the president has much of a choice other than to do everything he can short of kinetic confrontation.
I completely agree, and I think you and I talked about this maybe 10 days ago. I've been surprised at the incrementalism of the sanctions. I understand the logic of it up to a point, but we're kind of past the point where you need to hold anything back. Putin is grabbing the dirty tricks bag and pulling everything out. We need to really slam the economic door and strangle his economy. And I think you got to go after oil and gas. I'll tell you one thing they've done that I really applaud is going after the central bank, the Russian central bank assets, which the Russian central bank foolishly allowed significant portion of their war chest, their $500 billion that they've been holding back for this moment. Foolishly on their part, they parked a lot of those assets in the West. I think they underestimated the degree to which the Europeans would come along in these sanctions. So they don't have the foreign reserves they had hoped for. They're seeing massive personal sanctions and broad economic sanctions. As you say, oil and gas is kind of the last card to play. I think that's coming.
I hope it's tonight. It would make the State of the Union special. Now, I'm not a psychologist, and I don't project my impressions of leaders onto the media, because I'm not in a position to judge Putin's state of mind. I just know what he's doing, and what he's doing is reverting to Chechnya and Syrian tactics. In terms of what you've seen, I can judge the state of the mind of the German public, because all of a sudden, nearly 90% of them support massive hikes in defense spending. As a former NATO-allied supreme commander, that's got to surprise you and encourage you.
It's been quite amazing to watch something I've been personally lobbying for and advocating for, along with the entire U.S. government for, you know, three decades, and in my case, 4 years as Supreme Allied Commander, literally buttonholing Chancellor Merkel and then Minister of Defense Ursula von der Leyen, who's now the head of the European Union, personally buttonholing them and begging them to increase defense spending. And all of a sudden, in 48 hours, Vladimir Putin has shown he's a much better persuader than Admiral Jim Stavridis. So I'm highly encouraged by this. I think it's been a wake-up call for Europe. And by the way, watch Sweden and Finland. If you woke up in Stockholm and Helsinki and you're outside the NATO alliance, I think this is the week when you start demanding a NATO membership card out of your government. And boy, that's got to be part of Vladimir Putin's worst nightmare.
It should be. Now, I am surprised that the West has responded as quickly as it has. I'm gratified that it has. Now the question is the United States' response to all of this. Do you think we'll get an increase in defense spending tonight in the State of the Union?
I think we have to see that. And I think it will also be strongly supported on both sides of the aisle. And I hope that the Pentagon will seize the moment to move the dial on the choice of weapon system toward the new weapons of war, which are going to be cyber, unmanned systems, space, special forces, which are going to end up, I think, being highly useful in this situation. Those are systems we need. Do we still need significant, strong, if you will, conventional capabilities? Yes. And we also, by the way, need to keep our eye on China and other potential opponents. So the Pentagon, I know, has the plans in place to do that. It's going to need a little push from the president tonight, and then I think you're going to see both houses of Congress strongly support this.
Now, Admiral, I want to close by talking about the media. I listen very closely when Jack Keane is on and you're on. As high-ranking general and flag officers, I tend to lean in when those people talk. Less so when we've got colonels, very less so when we've got people like me talking about other than domestic politics. What generally, what's the quality of the commentary been in your view on the military side of this?
Oh, I think it's been quite good, partly because the U.S. government has been so, shall we say, so generous with its intelligence. I can't remember a conflict where the Pentagon laid out more clearly exactly what's happening on the ground. And of course, they do that not to make life better for military analysts, but in order to shine a light on what the Russians are doing. It's like having a burglar approaching your house. You know, job one is turn on all the outside lights so you can see exactly where he is and what he's doing. So I think the job of military analysts has been easier, if you will, because of the extreme generosity of the intelligence. And then secondly, because all of us have seen these playbooks now 3-4 times. We've seen Putin use these tactics in Georgia. You mentioned Chechnya earlier, Syria above all. I think the real dark end of the spectrum here is Putin gets deeply frustrated and decides to go big, meaning we're just not going to worry about collateral damage anymore, like he does in Syria, and start dropping buildings and taking out villages because Zelensky's cell phone signal was there. Pretty soon you've got Aleppo on the Dnieper River. That's where we go.
I think that's the case. Now, I want to close with a giant theory that I want to test on you. Europe's reaction has been surprising and encouraging. I think it's because the assumption was where there might be limited wars in the Balkans, where there might be a Georgia incursion, an incursion into Ukraine that results in a minor, that no one thought that a full-scale ground war in Europe was ever going to come back. And the fact that it is occurring, and we don't know where he's going to stop, and he put his weapons on high alert, the nuclear force, that just tells us that the Europeans have been dreaming a dream. You can't walk away from history. Do you agree with that? That's the shock, is that little wars were expected, minor provocations, nothing in Europe, but this just throws that all out the window?
100%. And as I've been saying, what we're witnessing is like watching the History Channel from 1939, except it's happening right in front of us. And second point to be made, the 1939 events to 45, that happened within living memory. You know, my mother is alive, vibrant. She remembers World War II. She remembers all of this vividly. In Europe, this rattles old and dangerous ghosts.
Admiral Stavridis, talk to you again next week. Keep up the schedule. I see you everywhere, and I'm glad that you're everywhere. You and Jack Keane are the guys I listen to, and I appreciate it. Thank you, Admiral. Let me remind everyone in the United States that the economic consequences of this will be reflected in rising gold prices, which are up in 1918. But the 10-year Treasury actually fell yesterday. It became cheaper to buy a home from AndrewandTodd.com. Went down to 1.839%. 1.839% for the 10-year Treasury. That's not the rate you'll get on your refinance or your new home or your second home purchase or your investment real estate purchase. That's the 10-year treasury on which most mortgage interest rates are based. Find out what you can borrow out of your house with a refinance or where you can buy something with your own money and down payment from Andrew Del Rey and Todd Avakian. You can call them at 888-1172. You can call them today. You can go to andrewandtodd.com and answer a few questions. They'll be right back to you. Their team is standing by, and they want to help you. AndrewandTodd.com. 888-1172. 888-1172. Coming right back on The Hugh Hewitt Show.
Portions of The Hugh Hewitt Show brought to you by Sierra Pacific Mortgage. For more info, call 888-1172.
Genius. His most amazing discoveries thought to be written in a lost journal. Now in the right hands, it could revolutionize the 21st century, but in the wrong hands.
Kill him. Jump.
If you can stop an earthquake, doesn't that mean you could start one too?
That's why that notebook should never fall into the wrong hands.
There's an old brown battered notebook in my office at work. You have to find it, take it, and keep it hidden at all costs. The G20 leaders meeting downtown, they're in danger. In fact, the whole of downtown could be in danger.
If we are to build a superhuman, we must first eliminate those who are flawed.
People are created equally. All of downtown, the high-rises were built on rollers to withstand horizontal shakes. A vertical quake this size could collapse half of downtown.
We have commenced the countdown.
Shall we stop this thing?
Save the universe!
This is Carol Platt-Liebau for townhall.com. Sometimes there are policies so destructive that at first you don't believe they're true. Joe Biden is currently defending one, his plan to award $450,000 to migrants separated from their families after entering the U.S. illegally. Children of deceased U.S. soldiers are separated from their parents permanently. They don't receive this kind of money. And migrants who enter the U.S. legally certainly don't get this kind of payout. The really big jackpot, it seems, is being reserved for the lawbreakers. There are some obvious truths here. First, behavior that's subsidized gets repeated. Joe Biden is effectively inviting many more illegal immigrants to breach America's open borders. Second, he's betting over time the payoffs will benefit his party in political terms. Meanwhile, the vast majority of Americans watch in shock and dismay as our president, the country's chief law enforcement officer, brazenly rewards lawbreaking, a clear violation of his oath to defend our nation's laws. It's a sorry sight indeed.
Streaming on Salem Now.
How a million children were placed with local foster families. Parents from all walks of life share their stories of overcoming the one-child policy by taking in orphans.
Go to salemnow.com.
Welcome back, America. 1-800-520-1234. What do you expect from the President's State of the Union tonight? I'll be on special report before he delivers that. I have very low expectations. I do not think he's going to sanction Russian oil and gas, which is the most important thing he could do. He leads from behind. He does whatever Germany does. Germany hasn't done that yet. It's not a strong group of people. It's that simple. By the way, the Republicans have scheduled the Republican governor of Iowa for the response, which was great before a war broke out in Central Europe. I think they ought to go and get Cotton or one of the other serious people who does defense and give a very serious, sober-minded assessment of what the president has done and hasn't done about Ukraine. Trent, Hermosa Beach, California, 1-800-520-1234. What are you expecting out of the president tonight, and what do you expect out of Ukraine?
Well, I don't expect a whole lot of Joe Biden tonight because I don't think he's real capable of giving us what we need. But in Ukraine, one of the things there nobody's talking about is the Holodomor that Joseph Stalin put upon Ukraine as precursor to World War II, and where he starved to death. You know, the numbers vary, but about 10 million people, according to Ann Applebaum, who is a Polish writer and historian who wrote a famous book now called Red Famine, which I read. And I also read the general's book on naval warfare. And so the bad blood is real. And the people of Ukraine are going to go full Josie Wales. And you get mad dog mean because you neither win nor live. And it's a battle, Hugh.
Oh, and if you haven't believed in the Ukrainian resistance before now, I assume that the rat lines to the West are open and running and that every kind of missile and weapon is flooding in, but I don't know if they're going to get there to the front in time. Putin is using Putin rules, and those are Chechnya rules, and that's the video out of Kharkiv this morning. He just destroyed the central of the town. He just bombed it to smithereens. He's not. Yeah, he is. He's an evil, evil thug. Trent, thank you. Rick is calling from Cleveland this morning, talking about Joe Biden's remarks tonight. Hello, Rick. Good morning from the land. Hey, Rick, you're on.
Hey, Hugh, how you doing?
Good.
What I hope Biden does not address tonight is what was on the first item of the document, of the U.S. Senate yesterday, which was not sanctioned. It was about the Roe versus Wade abortion stuff.
It was a symbolic vote that 48 Democrats voted for unlimited abortion last night. 49. I guess Raphael Warnock was missing and Joe Manchin voted no. So it's 48 yes, because the vice president didn't get to vote. 48 yes, yeah. Voted for unlimited abortion.
The issue was, that was their first item of
first
importance,
thing.
Not Ukraine,
because it's the Democrat. Bad? Well, what they're trying to do, they know a red wave is coming. They suffered their 31st resignation yesterday, 31 times. They've had someone walk over to the speaker's office and say, I'm done, I'm quitting, I'm going to get killed. Ted Deutch quit yesterday. Democrats are fleeing the Congress because the red wave is going to be so huge because of schools, because of inflation, because of appeasement, and not sanctioning Russian oil and gas. I think everyone will hear that that's not in the speech if it's not in the speech.
Right. Okay, thanks.
Thank you, my friend. Let me remind everyone that coming up next hour, I'm going to talk with the president of Colorist United. And Colorist United is a brand new sponsor. It's exposing the un-American politics of big businesses like American Express. American Express has now gone completely woke in their hiring and diversity policies. They would be unconstitutional if adopted by any government agency. So head over to unamericanexpress.com and get the details. And stick around because Colorist United President is on next hour with me to explain what they are doing. I also want to remind everyone, food for the poor. It's Fat Tuesday, right? It's the last day before Lent. And if you're like me, you're figuring out how to observe Lent. And mortification of the flesh is one of the things that you do. And that can be something as simple as fasting one day a week or half a day or whatever you can do without endangering your health. That's one thing to do. But you can also not only not eat yourself, you can feed the hungry. That's where food for the poor comes in. So I love doing my annual Food for the Poor campaign. They are sponsors of the show, and I love this campaign. The Fishing Miss Sue and I donate to it every year because it's direct beans and rice and water to Haiti and Honduras and Central American regions where there is nothing. And COVID for 2 years, a coup in Haiti, crime in Haiti, kidnapping in Haiti, a lot of aid agencies simply left, a lot of missionaries simply left, not food for the poor. They know how to do it. They know how to protect the deliveries of the food and the beans. They can navigate their way through a crime-infested, mob-ruled, gang-terrorized city of Port-au-Prince. Food for the Poor has partners that are local. They feed children $88 a year. One gift of $88 for 1 year will feed the child for the entire year, water for life. You can go much higher than that if you would like. You can go lower if you can't make $88, but you got to go first to HughHewitt.com. Hit the Give Life banner at the top. And I thank you in advance for everything that you do on behalf of Food for the Poor. The phone number for Food for the Poor is 855-359-4673. 855-359-HOPE. Start your Fat Tuesday with a donation to Food for the Poor at the Give Life banner at HughHewitt.com and come back. This is Hugh Hewitt for townhall.com. Buckle up for 2022. The year in politics is going to be rough. The midterm election year seems predestined to banish the Democratic majorities in both houses of Congress. The country senses infirmity in President Biden, and many worry that our adversaries in China, Russia, and Iran sense that opening too. The shadow campaign for the GOP nomination in 2024 opens now, with the clear frontrunner being former President Donald Trump. The ranks of the top tier among possible GOP presidential nominees in alphabetical order starts with two senators, Arkansas's Tom Cotton and Ted Cruz of Texas. Then we have the populist Florida Governor Ron DeSantis, the former Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, and South Carolina Senator Tim Scott. If the world grows even darker in the days to come, Cotton and Pompeo, two former soldiers, start with some advantages. It's possible one or more will run whether or not the former president does. My bet with 3 years to go is that Trump runs and runs hard. Buckle up. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
publicpolicy.pepperdine.edu. Trending now on the Larry Elder Show.
What the Supreme Court has said is you have to have a compelling state interest, and the compelling state interest that the Supreme Court found was the benefits that flow from having a diverse student body, whatever those benefits may be. But you have to have a diverse student body to get these certain benefits, okay? So that justifies this kind of racial alchemy in terms of admissions. Here's the problem. Increasingly at schools, you have, regardless of how supposedly integrated they are, you're getting more and more racial separatism, separate classes, separate dormitories, separate graduations. There's more and more of that going on. And one of the basic reasons for that is because of mismatch, because of the serious mismatch in academic qualifications between Asians, Latinos, blacks, and whites.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
You want to know what's even crazier and funnier in a sick way? There's a security guard right there. The shoplifter, the looter, walks right by the security guard who isn't doing anything. He's got a jacket on with the big security on the back of his coat. And he stands there and watches the guy. The guy literally brushes right by the security guard. The security guard, what are they paying the security guard for? Just to stand there? Why don't we just put mannequins up in stores in New York? I may never go back. I swear, I may never go back. New York is turning into a hellhole. And Democrats are watching it. They're letting it happen. I can't wait to get Joe Borelli's take on all of this insanity.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
You called your son. You personally promised him you would be here.
Lucas, I don't know how to help you.
Your daddy loves you. You gotta know it, pal. Do you
feel the love? Prayer is a powerful thing, Ethan. It really does work, if you believe.
What reason does he have to care about some guy who's supposed to be his dad, but he's never around?
I can't do it, I can't. I'm not ready for this, man.
I'm done with you.
We all deserve a second chance, right, Ethan?
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
This is Carol Platt-Lebow for townhall.com. Sometimes there are policies so destructive that at first you don't believe they're true. Joe Biden is currently defending one, his plan to award $450,000 to migrants separated from their families after entering the U.S. illegally. Children of deceased U.S. soldiers are separated from their parents permanently. They don't receive this kind of money. And migrants who enter the U.S. legally certainly don't get this kind of payout. The really big jackpot, it seems, is being reserved for the lawbreakers. There are some obvious truths here. First, behavior that's subsidized gets repeated. Joe Biden is effectively inviting many more illegal immigrants to breach America's open borders. Second, he's betting over time the payoffs will benefit his party in political terms. Meanwhile, the vast majority of Americans watch in shock and dismay as our president, the country's chief law enforcement officer, brazenly rewards lawbreaking, a clear violation of his oath to defend our nation's laws. It's a sorry sight indeed.
Trending now on the Charlie Kirk Show.
It seems like the Democrats tried their best to try to eliminate the filibuster, and it failed. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, thankfully, it did fail. Republicans stood united against that, as we have been from the very beginning, and Kyrsten Sinema and Joe Manchin also stood with us in preserving the rules and the customs of the Senate. These rules and customs go back more than 200 years, Charlie. They are directly downstream from why our founders created a Senate in the first place, to provide the sober second thought against radical sweeping change to our country. It's pretty amazing that 48 out of 50 Democrats were willing to blow up the filibuster. They were willing to break the rules to change the rules. And Charlie, that would have just been the first step towards redistributing political power in this country. The Democrats' next stop probably would have been to make Washington, D.C. a state, our federal city that is by far the most liberal jurisdiction in America. So the Democrats could get two more Democratic senators in perpetuity. The next stop would have been to pack our federal courts, to include the Supreme Court, to stop the courts from overturning any of these unconstitutional actions. This entire effort, Charlie, was not about just altering this or that public policy. It was about forever changing the structure of political power in our country. You sometimes heard the argument that, well, the Democrats shouldn't do this because the shoe was on their other foot. Their entire goal was to make sure, Charlie, that the shoe would never be on the other foot. So it was a critical day in the history of our country and the history of the Senate as an institution. And I'm glad we stopped these radicals. That's why we have to turn them out of power in November.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
Seminary?
Madre, padre, ¿quién está listo para ser transformado por el poder de su palabra?
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Morning, Glory America, State of the Union Day. I'm Hugh Hewitt. President Biden will be addressing a joint session of Congress tonight. Will be very thinly attended because of restrictions Speaker Pelosi has put into place. Masks will no longer be mandatory. I'm not sure if my first guest, Congresswoman Ashley Hinson from the 1st District of Iowa, will be there. Congresswoman, welcome back. Will you be in the audience tonight?
Well, certainly trying to, Hugh, but I received an indeterminate COVID test result, so we're trying to sort through that, and all of us had to go through the testing process to be able to be in the room. So we'll see. We just have to get that sorted out. And one thing's for sure, Hugh, I'm looking forward to holding the president accountable, hearing what he has to say tonight, and making sure that I'm continuing to tell Iowan stories here in Washington.
Now, tonight, you know the governor of Iowa, and I'm a big Kim Reynolds fan. I'm not sure I would pick her given events to do the response tonight because it's a national security night. What do you expect from the governor if no change is made?
Well, I think it's a clear contrast, Hugh, and that's exactly why our governor from Iowa is delivering that response. It's just a void in leadership at the White House. You look at how Governor Reynolds has led in our state. Kids have been in the classroom for over the year. She helped our small businesses to reopen safely. We just signed some bipartisan tax cuts into law last year. So what a contrast between what we're doing in Iowa, how we're running our state, versus how things are being run here in Washington, D.C.
I get that, but I'm not sure that she's going to be the right person to demand oil and gas sanctions effectively. You know, where there's cotton and they're your colleague. You're on appropriations. I am curious if you've heard rumblings about an increased defense appropriation, Congresswoman Hinson.
Yeah, we're having a conversation, I believe, on Thursday this week as members of the Appropriations Committee to try to figure out what we're doing there. We had obviously a classified briefing as members of Congress yesterday on the situation in Ukraine. It is dire what's happening there, and we need to make sure that we continue to stand with the Ukrainian people because President Putin in Russia is a bully. This is an unprecedented attack on a sovereign nation, and we need to make sure that we're providing them all the help that we can.
Now, in terms of that, Ken Calvert, your colleague from California, is the ranking Republican on the defense appropriations. Would we consider forward funding deterrent? Because our nuclear forces obviously have to be improved and modernized, especially the Columbia-class boomer submarines, and especially, I guess, ICBM silos are getting pretty old. Any conversation about that, Congresswoman?
Not yet. Again, I think it's a little premature. We haven't had a chance to get together as a conference, let alone as an appropriations committee, to have that discussion. But I can tell you this, that we are very, very concerned with the rhetoric coming out of Russia. We're very, very concerned that civilian lives continue to be lost. I'm encouraged by the fact that we are seeing our allies in the region finally step up. I think, unfortunately, what we saw with the sanctions that came, it was too little too late. We were saying, hey, we should have put these into place months ago so that they actually would have been a deterrent. And now we're seeing the results of what happens when you don't have that strong deterrent up front. He's invaded. They're taking it from a multi-front standpoint, and there's possibilities that other countries and many of our allies could be threatened as well.
Now, Ashley Hinson, Congresswoman, last night we were talking on Special Report about what the American people are saying. It's worse this morning. We're seeing atrocities, right? The bombing of downtown Kharkiv with cluster bombs, indiscriminate killing of civilians and children. And 57% of Americans, according to Quinnipiac, don't think the president has done enough. Do you think he will do more tonight?
Well, I certainly hope, because there's been a void in leadership in this area. Again, we heard from Secretary Blinken, Secretary Mayorkas, the general, our defense secretary yesterday. It's very clear that the administration is taking it seriously, what's happening in Russia. I don't want to, undermine that at all. But I think we do need leadership here to make sure that our allies, to make sure Ukraine knows that we are not going to let President Putin be successful in taking over this country.
Now, I want to close with a political question, Congresswoman. Have the new districts been drawn in Iowa?
Yes, they are. They're all set. We're out campaigning. We picked up 6 new counties, so lots of minivan time on the road, Hugh.
Did you keep your home? When some people get thrown out of their own districts.
Yeah, no, I'm very lucky. I continue to live with my family in Marion, Iowa, and we're pretty much, I think, 90% of the people I currently represent are in my new congressional district. So
did Iowa pick up a seat?
Make sure we get out and. Nope, we did not pick up a seat. We maintained our 4 that we have, and I think we have a real chance this year to make sure we have all 4 seats be Republican seats.
Oh, way to go. Congresswoman Hinson, thank you for joining me. Good luck on the Appropriations Committee. Spend on defense. Not a Not a penny for a tribute. Lots and lots and lots for defense, especially against a dictator like Putin. Congresswoman, good to talk to you. Let me remind everyone, andrewandtodd.com, 1-800-520-1234 is my phone number. Andrew and Todd's phone number is 888-1172. And I remind you about them now because I'm going to do a market update right now, sponsored by andrewandtodd.com. Yesterday, the Dow went down 166 and the NASDAQ went down 56 and the S&P went down 10. It was not a bloodbath. The sanctions are crushing Russia, but they are not impacting the United States yet. They might. This morning in Great Britain, the stock market there is down 1%, almost 3% down in Germany, almost 3% down in France. They are continental European powers, and therefore they're being drawn into what they view as a breakout war of aggression, the likes of which we haven't seen on the European continent since 1945. And therefore, you know, Georgia, yes. Ukraine 2014, yes. We did not respond as strongly as we could, but this is all out war with tank columns and carpet bombing and all the sort of things. Putin, you know, Chechnya in Europe is not what NATO had in mind. So all sorts of aid. The public opinion has turned on a dime. Joe Biden is slow, of course. He's figured this out last, but we know that it's important to do the sanctions on the oil and gas. Hopefully he will know by State of the Union tonight. The 10-year Treasury dropped a little bit overnight to 1.839. It was up close to 2% yesterday, and that shows money flowing into the United States because it's safe. That means your interest rates got a little bit better today. If you're out buying a house, seize the day. If you're out refinancing a house, call Andrew and Todd at 888-1172. There with Sierra Pacific Mortgage. They will do well by you. But they can't do well by you. They can't help you save money every month unless and until you call them. 888-1172. JD in Las Vegas. Good morning, JD. Hope you're supporting Adam Laxalt for Senate.
Good morning. Can you hear me?
I do.
I hope he comes out tonight and says he's going to reverse all of his executive orders and drill everywhere and frack everywhere and flood the market. And then he's going to fire Vice President Harris for incompetency on the border.
He can't do that. He can't fire Vice President.
I know that. And then hire Manchin somehow to go through the Senate and make him the Vice President and then retire himself.
Well, that's a nice wish list. It isn't going to happen because you can't make the Vice President resign. You can't.
Somehow or another, we should be able to find something that she's done in the past where she has to resign, and then he could hire Manchin as his vice president, confirm him in the Senate, and then resign. He's incompetent. I'm sure that you'll change your opinion on him after he got elected, right?
Well, no, I have the same opinion of Joe Biden, that he's been wrong about everything for 40 years.
Yeah, his incompetence has been hidden in the Senate because he was one for 100.
Okay. It wasn't hidden from Robert Gates, the former SecDef to Obama and Bush, said the man hadn't been right in 40 years on any major national security issue. And he's leading from behind and he's hiding. My number, by the way, is 1-800-520-1234 if you want to join in with J.D. So he's just hiding and he's destroying economies. I told you what the Democratic platform is. Appeasement abroad, inflation at home. Schools, teachers unions first, students and parents last, open border, closed police precincts. That's it. I keep telling you that that's their agenda. I think they're going to get wiped out in the fall. But tonight, I have one objective, an announcement of sanctions on oil and gas purchases. That's it, one objective. Joe Biden was in the microphone yesterday, was talking at a White House Black History Month event. And he got he made a statement that's so astonishing. If it were not for the war, I would have spent all day on it. Cut number 11.
Your help, we're going to keep pushing on this. And we're protecting our country's threshold liberty, the sacred right to vote, which I've never seen is under such attack. You know, it's always made it harder for blacks to vote, but this is trying to be able to figure out how to keep the black vote when it occurs from even counting.
Do you know, that's so extraordinary. It's such a lie. It's such a smear on the people of the American election system. Nobody keeps blacks from voting. Nobody keeps anybody from voting. It's the easiest thing in the world to vote in the United States. He also got asked a question there about nuclear war. Cut number 10. Cut number 10.
Mr. President, should Americans be worried about nuclear war?
No.
That's very reassuring. President of the United States is not exactly a redwood of fortitude in these trying times. Tonight he could turn it around, will he? We'll see. My phone number is 1-800-520-1234. 1-800-520-1234. Talk to you after the break on the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you by Food for the Poor.
This is Carol Platt-Lebow for townhall.com. Sometimes there are policies so destructive that at first you don't believe they're true. Joe Biden is currently defending one, his plan to award $450,000 to migrants separated from their families after entering the U.S. illegally. Children of deceased U.S. soldiers are separated from their parents permanently. They don't receive this kind of money. And migrants who enter the U.S. legally certainly don't get this kind of payout. The really big jackpot, it seems, is being reserved for the lawbreakers. There are some obvious truths here. First, behavior that's subsidized gets repeated. Joe Biden is effectively inviting many more illegal immigrants to breach America's open borders. Second, he's betting over time the payoffs will benefit his party in political terms. Meanwhile, the vast majority of Americans watch in shock and dismay as our president, the country's chief law enforcement officer, brazenly rewards lawbreaking, a clear violation of his oath to defend our nation's laws. It's a sorry sight indeed.
Trending now on the Charlie Kirk Show.
It seems like the Democrats tried their best to try to eliminate the filibuster, and it failed. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, thankfully, it did fail. Republicans stood united against that, as we have been from the very beginning, and Kyrsten Sinema and Joe Manchin also stood with us in preserving the rules and the customs of the Senate. These rules and customs go back more than 200 years, Charlie. They are directly downstream from where our founders created a Senate in the first place to provide the sober second thought against radical sweeping change to our country. It's pretty amazing that 48 out of 50 Democrats were willing to blow up the filibuster. They were willing to break the rules to change the rules. And Charlie, that would have just been the first step towards redistributing political power in this country. The Democrats' next stop probably would have been to make Washington, D.C. a state, our federal city that is by far the most liberal jurisdiction in America. So the Democrats could get two more Democratic senators in perpetuity. The next stop would have been to pack our federal courts to include the Supreme Court, to stop the courts from overturning any of these unconstitutional actions. This entire effort, Charlie, was not about just altering this or that public policy. It was about forever changing the structure of political power in our country. You sometimes heard the argument that, well, the Democrats shouldn't do this because the shoe was on the other foot. Their entire goal was to make sure, Charlie, the shoe would never be on the other foot. So it was a critical day in the history of our country and the history of the Senate as an institution. And I'm glad we stopped these radicals. That's why we have to turn them out of power in November.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
This really is a Leninist strategy. Lenin's old saying that the capitalists will sell us the rope by which we will hang them is what China's doing. The Soviets couldn't do it for a couple reasons. Number one, they didn't have the money. They didn't have a whole lot of rubles to throw around, and people in the West didn't want them. But number two, there was a lot bigger sense of social cohesion during the Cold War. The notion, if you're a corporate executive during the Cold War, that you would be playing footsies with the Kremlin was outrageous. And yet in the case of China, the human rights situation, the challenge to American national security is every bit as great. I would argue perhaps even greater than it was in the Cold War era. But Wall Street, Silicon Valley, they are all happy to not only do deals with them, but do deals with them that benefit the Chinese military and intelligence state, and they don't seem to particularly care that they do.
Well, there was stigma in helping the Soviets. There's no stigma in helping the Chinese communists.
That's right. And I think that, you know, part of that is there's been this naivete for decades that if we just gain some money, it's going to stop flowing.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube.
Welcome back, America. Captain Jerry Hendricks, retired United States Navy, longtime friend of mine. I keep on my desk here his book, To Protect, actually, To Provide and Maintain. It's right there if you're watching on the Salem News Channel. I have my reader's copy there, coffee-stained and heavily annotated. Jerry joins us now because I wanted to ask Captain Hendricks about the Russian attacks on the Ukraine coast appear to be unopposed by anything that Ukraine has done. Oh, Jerry.
Good morning, Hugh. And what we're seeing there with the Russians on the southern coast, that's in the Sea of Azov. And so what the Ukrainian Navy has been largely a little bit farther down the coast, more towards Bulgaria and Romania. And so they really haven't been concentrated in force there around Mariupol inside that little small Sea of Azov. So that's been a largely unopposed area for an amphibious landing. It's also one of the few places on the Black Sea where you can essentially do an amphibious landing. A lot of people don't understand that you really need appropriate shore conditions to be able to land troops easily in a quick fashion. So that's been a place where the Russians could come ashore. It's also in keeping with what we were expecting, which is that Putin wanted to establish a land bridge running from the two little statelets that he had been controlling since 2014, and then down to the Crimea. He had had a gap there, and so by landing there, they're able to provide this sort of secure land bridge to run between the two areas in the Donbass and then down to Crimea, which has been a strategic vulnerability. So this has been expected, and the Ukrainian Navy was never strong. A lot of their Navy was sold off over the last 25 years. So this is going pretty much as we expected. I would have liked to have had more U.S. presence in the Black Sea. I understood that there was a destroyer that was in an alert status to move there, but I haven't seen a lot of activity from the United States even observing, moving in close to observe what was going on. We've been largely standing back.
Now, Sam Rahmani has reported that Ukrainian pilots are in Poland to transfer 28 MiG-29s. To their Air Force, and they're going to fly them back. A total of 70 fighter jets from EU nations are being provided. You think Ukraine has enough planes, and do you think 70 will be effective in the war zone?
Well, 70 MiG-29s will be effective in providing air-to-air defense, so combat air patrol over the area. The problem, though, is the MiG-29 is not known as an attack aircraft, meaning doing air-to-ground operations. So it is not as versatile as, like, for instance, our FNA-18 ENF Super Hornets that the Navy flies, which can do both air-to-air and air-to-ground missions effectively. You know, I've been watching that convoy that's been lined up there, the 40-mile-long convoy outside of Kiev, and it struck me that essentially, a couple A-10 Warthogs would have a field day with something like that. But that's not something that's in there's not a high quantity of that within the Ukrainian Air Force. They don't have a lot of air-to-ground. They have a lot of air-to-air that is legacy force that's left over from their time being associated with the Soviet Union, planes like the MiG-29. And so I wish that they had more attack aircraft like Sukhois or something that was more aligned with an air-to-ground mission, but they just don't.
So what is your big takeaway after 6 days?
Well, my big takeaway is that leadership matters. The president of Ukraine has been nothing less than inspiring. As Admiral Stavridis said earlier this morning, it's amazing what a communicator he is. He seems to have a great feel for his people, and he's inspired them to resist. We see Ukrainians who left the country are now coming back into the country to supplement and add to the resistance force within Ukraine. If Putin decides, to continue this, I don't see him turning around. He doesn't seem to have the personality to declare that he has made a mistake. I think he's going to have a long slog of it as the Ukrainians come in. We're also seeing these volunteer forces coming from other Eastern European countries. There are Poles and there are volunteer units that are coming from the Baltic nations. As you see, American forces fall into Poland and into the Baltics that we've sent over there, they seem to be releasing some of their forces on a voluntary basis to go and fight for Ukraine.
that's a big deal. As you see that, because that has the potential of bringing those nations into the fight in a later time.
Very dangerous kinetic period. Jerry, good to talk to you. Captain Jerry Hendricks, go get to provide and maintain a Navy. We might be about to provide and maintain for a Navy out of a supplemental. We'll see what is said in the State of the Union tonight. Stay tuned, America.
Children being kept in a box in the library, excluded, put on display, and so on and so forth for that long. I kind of feel like, and I can tell you are a very caring mom, which is why you're bringing this public, but I kind of feel like that would happen for 2 hours, and I would be down there at that school and pulling my kid out, much less 2 to 10 weeks. Did they really endure that for that long?
They really did that for that long, and I really appreciate that question, and I've gotten that question a lot, and how we looked at it as a family is we could pull them and just go about our lives, and they'll just do this to someone else, or we could stay and fight and hold our ground. And my kids didn't want to leave that school. They've been in that school, my son, since first grade to eighth grade. They had their friends there. We still had hope that the trusted adults would do the right thing. And we eventually have pulled them to homeschool. But during those weeks, we were fighting. We have hundreds of emails to the administration, the Dallas ISD school board. We went down and I brought 30 or 40 grandmas and grandpas and other parents from other schools down to fight and speak on our behalf. Parents even scheduled protests, 3 protests outside the school. So we were fighting, but I think at this point in our country, the war has come into the family, and our kids can no longer be shielded from it. They needed to be guided through it, which we did as a family, to build a backbone and learn how to stand up and fight, because this is their next generation. So instead of shielding them from it, we help them move through it with grace, integrity, and dignity, and they came out stronger.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
You called your son. You personally promised him you would be here.
Prayer is a powerful thing, Ethan. It really does work, if you believe.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
This is Hugh Hewitt for townhall.com. Buckle up for 2022. The year in politics is going to be rough. The midterm election year seems predestined to banish the Democratic majorities in both houses of Congress. The country senses infirmity in President Biden, and many worry that our adversaries in China, Russia, and Iran sense that opening too. The shadow campaign for the GOP nomination in 2024 opens now, with a clear frontrunner being former President Donald Trump. The ranks of the top tier among possible GOP presidential nominees in alphabetical order starts with 2 senators, Arkansas's Tom Cotton and Ted Cruz of Texas. Then we have the populist Florida Governor Ron DeSantis, the former Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, and South Carolina Senator Tim Scott. If the world grows even darker in the days to come, Cotton and Pompeo, 2 former soldiers, start with some advantages. It's possible one or more will run whether or not the former president does. My bet, with 3 years to go, is that Trump runs and runs hard. Buckle up. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
Publicpolicy.pepperdine.edu. Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
Look at you! Ow! Hey, I wasn't ready for that.
And there goes Peter Dinklage beating the crap out of Will Ferrell for calling him an angry elf. I mean, listen, he's certainly not an elf, but he's an angry guy. You know, I hate to put everything in a political perspective here, but isn't it true? And I assume Peter Dinklage is no conservative. He's woke. He wants to cancel Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. Why do they always want to cancel everything? You know, they want to cancel everything. What do conservatives believe in? We are for things. Biden's always saying, "What are Republicans for? Not for anything." Yes, we're for everything. We're for people. We're for people's right to make decisions about their health. We're for movies. We're for different views on the airwaves. We're not for people being canceled or movies being canceled or things being canceled. We're for things. And your side, Biden, is against everything. You're against Snow White and the Seven Dwarves. Oh, I mean, Disney obviously taking it seriously because they're redoing the whole movie, I guess. What? Seriously, what do you portray them as children? Should child actors play the Seven Dwarves? You're going to get little Billy or Susie, who's about nine? The Seven Dwarves and...
Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt, joined by United States Senator Tom Cotton from Arkansas. Good morning, Senator.
Good morning, Hugh. It's good to be on with you.
To your great disappointment, I'm not going to ask you five questions about Donald Trump. I just don't understand interviews that go that way. I'm going to ask you about the State of the Union and what you want to hear tonight. I want to hear sanctions on Russian gas and oil. Do you expect we'll get that?
Hugh, I don't expect we'll get that, but we should get it. To your broader point, Joe Biden has been caught on the back foot from the very beginning. We have ceded the initiative to Vladimir Putin for 4 or 5 months. During that time, I've been urging the president to take quicker action, more decisive action, and tougher action. Early sanctions, more deliveries of weapon systems, and to make it clear what would happen if Vladimir Putin went down this path. Now, unfortunately, he didn't do that. I think along with his concessions to Putin over the last year, emboldened Vladimir Putin, as well as the disastrous withdrawal from Afghanistan. Right now, some of our European allies are actually moving faster than we are, which is good for them, although they should have been moving earlier too. But there's still more things we can do. One of the most important things we could do, as you say, Hugh, is announce oil and gas sanctions. So we're no longer sending hundreds of millions of dollars every day to Vladimir Putin's war machine, and make the SWIFT sanctions comprehensive, to cut off every bank in Russia. You know, Democrats keep saying that, well, we've sanctioned 80% of the banks in Russia. Unfortunately, Vladimir Putin controls 100% of the banks in Russia. So 20% of the banks can be used to evade these sanctions over time. And then, of course, we need to continue to rush even more weapons to the front so the brave Ukrainian people have done such a valiant job over the last week of defending themselves can continue to do so.
Senator Cotton, we are, quote, leading from behind, close quote, again. This is the famous Barack Obama formulation that governed our Libya policy when Secretary of State Hillary Clinton was in charge and Tony Blinken was the vice president, now President Biden's National Security Advisor. We're back to leading from behind. The Europeans are actually tougher than we are. Germany, of all people, is doing more than we are. They've already voted 100 million euros into a special fund. Will the appropriators get to work? Will armed services and intel get to work and get a supplemental done?
Hugh, unfortunately, I'm not actually seeing that kind of urgency, and it's not just from the appropriators. Also from the Biden administration, we've now had two separate cabinet-level conversations with the full Senate. And in both of those conversations, they've had a chance to ask for more money. They've been specifically asked by Republican senators, how much more money will you need in the supplemental bill? How much more money will you need in the annual defense bill? And in both of those instances, they've refused to give an answer. It just goes to show, again, that the Biden administration is still not taking seriously the threats that we faced. Part of the reason we're in this situation is they thought that they could simply talk Vladimir Putin out of his longstanding ambition, as opposed to back it up with the credible threat of force, both economic force and weapons into the hands of Ukrainians.
Now, we've seen the effect of this.
The invasion, we still haven't seen that.
We've seen the effectiveness of the javelins, and I know that President Trump authorized them. It was a slow deployment of the javelins to Ukraine. Secretary Esper, when he was Army Secretary, was not very enthusiastic about this, but they got there. Now Germany is sending Stingers, which are ground-to-air missiles, which take out the Russian Air Force. Apparently, we're going to do that as well, but do you have any idea of how fast and how many we're sending?
Hewitt, I don't want to get into how much the United States are self-sending. We're also working with our partners to send them, and some of those partners naturally are getting them there very fast, given their proximity to Ukraine. But it's still not fast enough, and there's not enough. We should have been stockpiling these things in Ukraine for the last 6 months. You ask the Biden administration or my Democratic colleagues why we weren't doing that, and they blame Volodymyr Zelensky. They say that he didn't want them. He didn't ask for them. It's like, well, part of effective diplomacy is encouraging your allies to do the right thing if they even are speaking what is a factual matter. What these Ukrainians needed was to have these weapons ready and available in large scale. So none of these columns you see moving down the street, none of the aircraft you see in the sky could do so with impunity. They have proven to be very courageous and valiant fighters and skilled fighters when they have the arms they need. But clearly, they're going to need more, and they should have had more already, and we should be getting them more.
I'm not sure you've seen the video from Kharkiv yet this morning of the devastated center of the city where cluster bombs and other munitions, allegedly a vacuum bomb as well, that's an allegation, not a proven thing, but the cluster bomb has been proven by Bellingcat. I am curious whether there isn't some level of international opprobrium that can still be brought to bear on every Russian. They fired the head of the Berlin Symphony today. He's a Putin pal. Is it time to send home the NHL Russia's player? Is it time to really make Russia feel this?
Well, Hugh, to give you an example of why Vladimir Putin thought he could get away with this, you just saw the ridiculous spectacle at the Winter Olympics of something called the Russian Olympic Committee competing. Even though Russia's had a widespread systematic doping program for its Olympic team for years and years and years, and we made a show of kicking them out of the Olympics, and we turned around and let them compete. If you can't even enforce the rules in a game, why do you think Vladimir Putin would worry about you enforcing the rules when it comes to warfare?
True.
Just every Russian who bears any degree of culpability, especially the oligarchs who have gotten rich and powerful off of Vladimir Putin's regime, should be paying the price for this invasion. At the same time, Hugh, I think it's important to remember that the first victims of Vladimir Putin's aggression and brutality are the Russian people.
Now,
and I also credit those brave Russians in places like St. Petersburg and Moscow who are protesting by the thousands. Hugh, this is not like America, where you can go out and protest whatever your politics are. Protesting Vladimir Putin can bring a death sentence to you. So we should... And look at what some of these conscripts in the Russian army are doing in Ukraine as well, Hugh. They didn't even know that they were in Ukraine. They thought they were doing training exercises in Belarus. This is not a war of Russia on Ukraine. This is Vladimir Putin's war against Ukraine.
Your longtime friend Secretary Pompeo was on yesterday denouncing the fact that we're back in negotiations with the Iranians through Russian proxies. There were Russians at the table speaking on our behalf in Vienna yesterday. Does anyone in the Senate... on the other side, raise a voice about this? We've got to cut them out of everything, and we can't do a deal with the Iranians. Talk about projecting weakness. That would be the ultimate in projecting weakness.
It's just another example of why Putin probably thinks he can get away with this in the long run. If we're cutting them off from European airspace and taking their soccer clubs and seizing their yachts and sanctioning some of their banks, yet we'll sit down with them at the negotiating table with Vienna to try to get a terrible nuclear deal with Iran. He knows that Joe Biden is not serious about fighting this fight for the long run. Just like we've isolated Vladimir Putin in so many other ways, we should not be negotiating a dangerous nuclear deal with his aid with Iran.
There was a shouted question at the president yesterday, are you afraid of nuclear war? He said no. What did you make of Putin's upping of his nuclear forces alert level?
Nuclear saber-rattling, Hugh, is a long-standing tool of Russian statecraft, whether it's Soviet Russia or Vladimir Putin. And when Russia engages in nuclear saber-rattling, what they are doing is trying to frighten Western leaders, to include America, into diminished resolve and unwillingness to confront their aggression. There's no need for us at the moment that I'm aware of to go to any other more heightened nuclear posture. After all, our nuclear missiles are always ready to fire on just a moment's notice, and our submarines are always on patrol. But it's also not a time for diminished resolve in the face of nuclear saber rattling, because resolution where others waver is a hallmark of leadership among nations and men.
Are you going to be attending the State of the Union tonight, Senator?
Well, Hugh, they've been mandating some COVID theatrics, you know, social distancing and masking and testing. I think that they're thinking about removing those. I won't get engaged in those theatrics, but if they remove those, then I may be there. We'll see.
I would like people to sit on their hands when he says things short of sanctioning gas and oil, because that's the last thing we can do.
I don't know. You may have seen the news at the White House today. They're no longer requiring masks. They say the data has changed. I agree. The data has changed. The polling data shows that Joe Biden and his COVID policies are massively unpopular, and they know that it's going to cause them to get beaten badly this November. So that's the data that's changed at the White House, and that data may have changed in Nancy Pelosi's house as well.
You know, the polling data also showed from Quinnipiac that 57%, that's a big number, as you know, 57% don't think President Biden has been strong enough on Ukraine. Does that penetrate the claimed defenses at the White House? Does someone get inside the blue bubble and say to the president, sanction Russian oil and gas?
No, unfortunately, Hugh. I mean, what we saw at that briefing to the senators last night was people that are trapped in that bubble, patting themselves on the back about the robust, unprecedented diplomatic coalition they built, which, Hugh, to me, sounds kind of like Neville Chamberlain celebrating the coalition he built to declare war on Germany after it invaded Poland in September 1939. The whole point of building a diplomatic coalition is you do so in advance, backed by strength, to avoid war in the first place.
Were they really giving themselves high fives?
Yes, Hugh, absolutely. It's the same rhetoric you've seen on television from the president's spokesman and his cabinet members, celebrating what a great diplomatic response it's been since Vladimir Putin invaded Ukraine, not acknowledging that the invasion of Ukraine is the failure of policy to begin with.
Will you be doing any media after the speech tonight, Senator?
I don't know you.
Well, I hope you are one of the people that mark whether or not he does the one thing he needs to do, which is sanction oil and gas sales and those who receive them. Last question, would you agree it's not just sanctions on Russian oil and gas, but people who transship them and buy them should be sanctioned?
Yeah, Hugh, there's a lot of things that we can do, stuff that goes into kind of the international plumbing of markets, whether it's ships, which transport about two-thirds of Russian oil, the insurance companies that insure those shipments, and similar kinds of targets along the entire supply chain of Russian oil until it gets to the point of the end use.
I will look for those. Senator Cotton, always a pleasure. Thank you. Senator Tom Cotton from Arkansas, we'll check in with him again next week. I'm not an optimist, but I still continue to hope something happens. Please don't forget Food for the Poor. It's Fat Tuesday. The last day before Lent, a lot of people go crazy in places like New Orleans, and they go partying in New York City. Before you go out to party tonight, think about children who've got nothing to eat in Haiti and Honduras and Nicaragua. Haiti's a mess. I mean, we can't help the people in Kharkiv. We can't do that. But a child starving in Haiti is like a child starving in Ukraine. You can help a child in Haiti. If you go over to HughHewitt.com, at the very top, you will see a banner that says, Give Life. And you can make your contribution. It's so easy to do. All it requires is 5 minutes, literally 5 minutes over there. Or you can call the Food for the Poor line, 855-359-HOPE, 855-359-4673. ReliefFactor.com. If you got to listen to a Joe Biden speech, you need ReliefFactor.com. I'm really hoping they've decided to go in there and say it's a bad night. I got to get back to the Situation Room and therefore spend more money on defense and sanction gas and oil, and I'm with you. And then he leaves. That would be a good thing. It'd actually improve. I just read he's going to talk about nursing homes. Honestly, I don't get it. ReliefFactor.com, I do get. I do get the need to be free of the minor aches and pains that accompany getting aging and getting older. And you're definitely going to get older today, but you ought to be out there getting exercise. Did I say aging? Getting exercise or getting older. Go exercise, go walk, go run, go swim today. Take relieffactor.com. Join the tens of thousands of people who do so. I'm coming back with Kenny Hsu to talk about American Express. Don't go anywhere.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by Color Us United.
Peter Dinklage beating the crap out of Will Ferrell for calling him an angry elf. I mean, listen, he's certainly not an elf, but he's an angry guy. You know, I hate to put everything in a political perspective here, but isn't it true? And I assume Peter Dinklage is no conservative. He's woke. He wants to cancel Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. Why do they always want to cancel everything? You know, they want to cancel everything. What do conservatives believe in? We are for things. Biden's always saying, what are Republicans for? Not for anything. Yes, we're for everything. We're for people. We're for people's right to make decisions about their health. We're for movies. We're for different views on the airwaves. We're not for people being canceled or movies being canceled or things being canceled. We're for things. And your side, Biden, is against everything. You're against Snow White and the Seven Dwarves. Oh, I mean, Disney obviously taking it seriously because they're redoing the whole movie, I guess. Do you portray them as children? Should child actors play the Seven Dwarves? You're going to get little Billy or Susie, who's about 9? The Seven Dwarves in Snow White aren't children. Grumpy isn't a kid. I mean, in fact, that would be a great, if they're casting people, maybe Peter Dinklage can play Grumpy. Because he bit right in.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
We'll see one young lady identify as transgender, and the next thing you know, 6 or 7 young ladies in that same school are now identifying as transgender.
Children taught at age 5, they can create their gender identity, and it's being celebrated.
Schools are lining up to push the transgender agenda on kids and cut parents out of the equation.
Every cell of their body that has a nucleus is male or female.
We've now seen parents losing custody of their children if they don't go along with this.
We've all been created XY or XX, so that means there's only 2 genders. And so really the battle is against the creator.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. Breaking news. The EU is sending 16 Bulgarian MiG-29s, 28 MiG-29s from Poland, and 12 MiG-29s from Slovakia to Ukraine. And Bulgaria is sending 14 Su-25s. Those are the ground support planes that can chew up columns. More on that as it occurs. I'm joined now by Kenny Hsu. I told you I have a brand new sponsor of the Hugh Hewitt Show, Color Us United, which is rejecting what American Express has done in their unamericanexpress.com campaign. Kenny, welcome to the Hugh Hewitt Show. Glad to have you as a sponsor. Tell us about Color Us United.
We advocate for a race-blind America. That's what Color Us United does, colorusunited.org. That means that we conduct institutional guerrilla warfare against institutions that have gone woke. I mean, CRT in schools, they're creating the demand side. They're creating the demand for wokeness among children, but also corporations like American Express, who by their un-American policies are creating a supply of wokeness through things like ESG, their DEI trainings, their hirings based on race and equity. That's what we are campaigning against. We're sending a message at unamericanexpress.com, and you should join in. Make your voice known. We don't want wokeness or politicization of our corporations.
ESG stands for environmental, social, governmental policies, and this became all the rage about 5 years ago, but they ignore things like genocide in Syria and Russian aggression against Ukraine. Meanwhile, they worry about America's sins of the last 400 years. So, Kenny, what does someone do when they go to unamericanexpress.com? Unamericanexpress.com is where the first campaign of Colorist United is underway.
Exactly. And you know what is so ironic about ESG? They will never hold China to the same standards that they're holding America and the West with environmental and social governance. They say, oh, we need diversity in our board membership in America. 15% Black Americans, they'll never say that. But with ESG and everything that's going on, what you can do when you go to unamericanexpress.com is we have a petition for you that you want to sign, make your voice known, say we need to stop Amex's woke policies. We'll go directly to Amex CEO Steve Squeri, and hopefully it'll be put up for a vote at the end of May in Amex's annual board meeting.
You know, this battle was fought in the 90s in places like California, where a race-neutral mandate was imposed upon state action. Right now, with this Supreme Court, if the government were to do what American Express was doing in its hiring, that would be unconstitutional. Do you expect to make a difference, Kenny? Or is this about stopping the next corporation from doing what American Express has already done?
I think we can make a huge difference if we organize the voices of millions of angry Americans. We know wokeness is unpopular. We saw the election of Glenn Youngkin in Virginia based on CRT in schools. We know the backlash against BlackRock that's been happening because of their ties to China. Now we know that American Express, by adopting these race-based policies, is doing something completely un-American. That's the Un-American Express, unamericanexpress.com. And the only way we're going to be able to stop wokeness is if we organize the voices of millions. And that's what Colorist United is set up to do.
When did Amex adopt their diversity and equity guidelines?
In the wake of George Floyd. Actually, they've always had it, but they were much more aggressive about it after George Floyd. And what I've heard from employee testimony is that it's damaged the culture at Amex significantly. They used to be such a great employer for all races. Now they're inspiring racial resentment because now you can't even criticize a person of a certain race, or if you try to fire a person of a certain race, they're going to come after you as well. They're totally bent on hiring based on race, on making sure that they meet certain racial quotas to look good. It's not about meritocracy anymore. It's not about promoting based on who's the most qualified or who makes the company most profitable. It's about promoting based on this devious idea of race and social class.
Kenny, I'm pretty sure that a bunch of the Russian oligarchs have got the highest level card, not platinum, but whatever the ebony card is, the big card. Have we seen American Express say anything about Putin's war crimes?
Absolutely not. Absolutely not. They are, and speaking about that Amex black card, the reason why we believe our campaign with the voice of millions against Un-American Express will be successful is because they're so reliant upon their brand, right? Un-American Express gets more value per customer than Visa or MasterCard, about four times as much, because they're so reliant upon that prestige of that brand. But if we can show that what they're doing is actually un-American, then we can show with the voices of millions that this is not something that people will stand for.
Head over to unamericanexpress.com or just go direct to colorusunited.org. Colorusunited.org, three words all together, colorusunited.org, or head to unamericanexpress.com. Kenny, thank you. Continue. Good luck with your campaign. Great to have you on board as a sponsor. I have long been a proponent of colorblindness in the United States. The only way the country works is colorblind. The only way. A country this diverse can only work if every citizen is a citizen in full and none is less than a citizen in full. Thank you, Kenny. Thank you, Adam and Ben. Thank you, Generalissimo. The latest on State of the Union tomorrow. I'll be on special report tonight before the State of the Union gets going to tell you what I expect, which is not much, but maybe there'll be some leaks that will turn it around in the course of the day. Pray for Ukraine. See you tomorrow on the next Hugh Hewitt Show.